Well, hey, y'all. Hey, happy hump day, everybody. And welcome, everyone, to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speak. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Y'all know the routine. Do me a favor, love up on my moderator, Love Jones, please, and thank you. And also make sure that you've shown some good manners and like the video on your way in the door, all right? And if you haven't already, go ahead and subscribe to the channel, making sure that you click that notification bell and select all so that you don't miss out on a single solitary chapter, child. Listen. With that being said, welcome to all of my new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing, and I hope you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my nosy-ass returning sippers and speakers. And those of you catching this on the replay, thanks for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love the way that y'all love on me. Look at YouTube's janky ass child just now sending me the notification that I am in fact live on my own YouTube channel. Child, just slow boppers for Christ, the whole you did. You heard me? All right, so let's see who is in the building with me today. All the nosy folks. Kim Cash in the building before the moderator. Watch out. Oh, wait, maybe not, because I think it may have deleted all of Love Jones' hard work, but that's all right. Hey, girl, hey, and welcome to you, Love Jones. Happy hump day. Moderator extraordinaire, thank you so much for being here. And you, Kim Cash, here early, child. Okay, child, Kim Cash, I told you, they just sent me the notification. Like, literally, I just got it. All right, so I don't even understand what the hell. Hey, Choco Chip. Happy hump day, darling. Thank you for sliding into the speakeasy and bringing a whole cauldron of good vibes with you, darling. Welcome. And welcome to you, Shanae. Happy hump day, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I truly appreciate you. We got Marva and her freezer door in the building. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here as well. I appreciate you. Happy hump day and welcome. Child, listen. This has been one heck of a day already. Child, I've been running around like a chicken with my head cut off, frustrated, constipated, irritated, aggravated, agitated. Child, just discombobulated. But I'm here, all right? If I knew all my nosy-ass sippers and speakers was ready for me to finish this book, child. We waiting on Messiah to make his presence known. Bald head and all, child. Of course, he might have grown his hair back, but I don't know. We gonna see, though. All right, so let me get my time stamp, child, so we can get this party started. I hope everybody's having a good hump day, and I hope I didn't miss anybody, and I hope all of y'all like the video on your way in, child. All right, so let's get this party started, honey, because, listen, we ain't got all day to be fooling around with Morgan. All right, chapter 15. Morgan was sick to her stomach as she waited at the airport. The longer she stood near baggage claim, the more she began to regret calling Bash to town. When they were apart, she had freedom. She could be herself. As soon as she saw his smiling face, she felt it being rescinded, like he was repossessing her ability to make her own decisions. With every step he took in her direction, Morgan's inside screamed, "Run!" "My girl," he groaned as he bent down to wrap her in a hug, lifting her. Her feet left the ground for a split second. He placed her down, and Morgan felt guilty because he had missed her, she could tell. And while he was missing her, Morgan had been in the throes of something so passionate it made her blush just thinking about it. Child, that's the Meek effect. Ooh, Lord. Anyway, where are the twins, he asked. At Alani and Ethics, she informed. Do you have bags, she asked. Nah, I didn't pack much. I have an entire Michigan wardrobe at the house here. I'm good. I just brought work, he said. Are you ready for commencement? I am. 2 years of nonstop work and sleepless nights are finally paying off, she said. I'm right out front. I'm ready for his ass to hop back on the next thing smoking back over there to his constipated ass mammy with her stick in the mud ass. Anyway, she led the way to her car, and she couldn't help but notice that the giddiness she felt with Amik was missing. I bet it is, hell. She had been away from Bash for an extended period of time, and it was like she didn't even care. It hadn't even been 24 hours of being without Amik, and Morgan's heart was bleeding. He hadn't called or texted. He did what he was told. He fell back. Hey, you good, Mo? Bash asked. She shook the thoughts of another man from her mind and nodded, putting on the fake smile she had mastered around him before heading to her place. She should have taken him home to his family's estate, but she needed him to play interference. She needed him to stop her from losing control of her emotions. Morgan had to be rational. She had invested the past 2 years of her life into being with Bash. She allowed him to play daddy to her children, and things had been good. Well, maybe not good. Tolerable. Things had been uncomplicated for 2 whole years. When Aria had brought Amik to London, her entire world had been shaken up. Yeah, of course I'm fine, she lied. Always lying, always concealing how she felt around him, always forcing a smile while thoughts of despair swirled in her head. But she feigned normalcy. She faked it because if she told anyone her true thoughts, they would think she was crazy. They would think she was depressed and suicidal. They would overanalyze and control. Ethic would worry and her family would look at her with skeptical eyes. So instead, she pretended she was happy. A lot of women had a lot less, so certainly Morgan should be grateful for Bash. They arrived at her place, and as soon as they were through the door, Bash's hands were on her, pulling her into him, kissing her, and Morgan cringed. Bash, stop, she whispered as she shimmied out of his grasp. I know, you got your rules, Mo, he conceded, lifting his hands. He had no idea the ways in which she had broken those rules. Sex after Messiah scared her until Amik. Now, the thought of him touching her body sent a flood through her panties. She had come 3 times just thinking about him the night before, but Bash saw no action. It was like her body didn't even respond the same, like her sexual language was French and he was speaking Mandarin. Together, they just weren't fluent. Her phone buzzed and she felt like she had been saved by the bell. She made her way to the living room. Why don't you go shower? This is Aria. I need to take this, she said. She answered, Hey, girl, not too long. It's not often that I get you all to myself. I don't want to share you with anyone else, Bash mumbled in her ear as he passed. Boy, shut your ass up, Aria shouted, expressing her frustration with Bash. Guess your warden is in town, huh? Yeah, he got in not too long ago, Morgan informed. Why did this man show up a day before the show? He probably smelled the fun that was about to go down, Aria fussed. What show? Morgan asked. Vegas, Morgan, what do you mean? What show? We talked about this. You said you'd perform, Aria reminded. I can't, Aria Mo said. Bash is back. We have the twins to think about. I can't just pick up and go away for the weekend. And why the hell not? Bash want to play daddy, so let that nigga play daddy. He can watch the twins while you come to Vegas and do the show, Aria stated. Aren't the twins still at Ethics anyway? Morgan knew Alani and Ethic would care for her babies. She was looking for excuses not to go. Bash's presence was already changing the way she made decisions. She wanted to go. He wouldn't want her to go, however. So to avoid conflict, she would just sit this one out. Mo, you said you would perform, Aria stated. You owe me. I came all the way to London for your ass. When the hell did I say that? She protested. In London, that night at the dance studio, you agreed. The promoter already has your name on the bill. You haven't hit the stage in 2 years. Bitch, I danced with you the other night, Mo argued. A club gig is not a show. You can do that shit in your sleep. Come on, Mo. People are hyped to see you again. Plus, he's paying $100,000, Mo. Split 4 ways, we walk away with a nice little bag. Morgan rolled her eyes. It was good money, but money didn't move Morgan Atkins. Between Raven's life insurance and the money Ethic had put up for her over the years, she was set. She didn't have to lift a finger if she didn't want to, but the fact that she was good enough to command that large of a fee after 2 years of disappearing from the scene made her consider it. Plus, y'all don't forget she got the money from Messiah. What the fuck did she do with that? I know she didn't just like ball a check up and throw it in the garbage, because if that's the case, she truly is a motherfucking slow bopper for Christ. 1 second, y'all. This is y'all grandma. Hold on. Okay, I'm sorry, y'all. I appreciate y'all for waiting for me. All right. Okay. He's gonna hate this. His family doesn't like the look. It doesn't fit their image. Who cares about what they like, Mo? Do you like it? Bash knew you were gang when he met you. Now he has you serving tea and biscuits and shit. It's like you're not even the same person with him, Aria said. Morgan could hear the irritation in Aria's voice, and she couldn't blame her because it reflected in her soul. Fuck these niggas, Mo. You don't have to change with every relationship you get into. Who are you when you're alone? When you look in the mirror, the Mo I know ain't the one I saw in London. Morgan knew Aria was right. She had been stifling herself. She loved to dance, but she always hid that part of her while in London. The urge to dance, the urge to be loud, the urge to be herself. She was a muted version of Morgan Atkins with Bash, one his parents would accept, a version Christiana had taught her to be. She was already the girl with two babies out of wedlock. Bash was already accepting children that weren't his. She felt obligated to be what he needed, what he preferred. Go on IG and look at how many people have commented on my flyer. If I show up without you, they're gonna boo us off the set, no matter how fire it is, Aria said. I'll think about it, Mo answered. Look, I'll forward you the flight reservation. I leave tonight. Your flight is for tomorrow morning. Be on it, Morgan. I said I'll think about it, nigga. Don't Morgan me, Mo fussed. She hung up the phone and opened her Instagram. The first thing she saw was a notification for a direct message. She opened it. Murder King 810. You look unhappy, and I ain't happy about that. You vibrate too high for your smile not to match. Fix that. Mo frowned. She normally ignored messages from men, but she found herself typing back. Shorty doo wop. You get all that from an IG post, huh? Does this introspective, I pay attention, I can see past your smile thing normally work for you? To Morgan's surprise, instant dots danced on the screen. Murder King 810. I've only ever tried it on you. It works because I know for a fact you're smiling right now. Morgan felt her face turn red and her mouth opened in shock. Boy, you don't know shit. You don't know me. Have a nice day, sir, and stop sliding in DMs. It makes you seem thirsty. Murder King 810. A nigga could use a sip of that. Morgan snickered and her fingers were lightning on the screen. Never happening, bruh. Move around. Murder King 810. I've tried. I'm stuck on you. Shorty doo-wop, good luck with that. Oh, change the name. I hate it. It's corny. Morgan clicked out of the message and went to Aria's page. Stiletto gang fans were swarming the comments under Morgan's picture. Her thumb slid down the screen as Bash entered the room, wearing a towel around his waist, his wet body dripping onto her floor. His toned abdomen, Ritz cracker-colored skin, and full beard was more than attractive. Bash was a man who attracted women daily, but somehow Morgan didn't feel it. No spark, no butterflies. Oh, how she wished for those butterflies with him. Maybe then she could keep herself away from Amik. What time do we have to pick up the twins? Bash asked. Ethics said he would call, which means never, Morgan snickered. Damn, I miss them. Should we go pick them up? He asked. He walked to her and took her chin in his hand, then leaned down to kiss her. A quick peck, never more. Never passion-filled, but Morgan still felt his appreciation. She knew he was giving all he knew how to give. His family had bred up a gentleman. They haven't seen them in months. No way is Alani letting them go today, she said, smiling. It's crazy how she loves on them. I fought her for a long time, but nobody loves like Alani. I'm glad that they have her and Ethic. She's good people. Ethic doesn't care for me too much, but what father does, right? I'd like to talk to him about the engagement. I'd like to be the one to let him know, if that's okay with you. I didn't get the chance to ask his permission, and I'd still like to, Bash said. I don't know, Bash. I think I should be the one to tell him. He's my father. He raised me. That news should come from me, Morgan said. You make it sound like you're delivering bad news, Mo, he said, worry filling his forehead as lines creased his face. Morgan took a deep breath. That's not what I mean. Do I not give you everything? Do I not do everything for you? I got you into the medical program at Cambridge next year. I help with the twins so you can go full time, taking them to class with me daily. My students know them. They're there so much. You finished 4 years of undergrad in 2 years because of me. I believe in you. I'm here every step of the way. My mother has you on the fast track at the finest hospital in London after you finish medical school. A surgeon in the family goes a long way. We've all invested in you, Mo. Nigga, so? If she don't want your punk ass, she don't want you. The fuck? See, this is what I'm saying. Soon as a nigga think he doing something for you, then all of a sudden now you owe him. Like, what the fuck? She don't owe you shit, sir. Like, fuck out of here. The fuck you thought? Like, that ain't cool, y'all, for him to be doing that, like pushing up on her like that and trying to guilt trip her into some shit. Like, bruh, you doing too much. Hold on, y'all. Let's see. Oh, come on, y'all. Hold on, let me see. Hold on, y'all, one second. Okay, sorry y'all. I'm trying to do take care of business and read to y'all. I'm sorry. So he's trying to browbeat her into like guilt her into being with him. And that's some bullshit. Like, the fuck you thought, sir? Just because you did all that, ain't nobody ask you and your ugly ass mammy to do that. Y'all did that because y'all wanted to, but it's not fair for y'all to try to browbeat me into that. But whatever, child. I just feel like that's real disrespectful. I really do. And I feel like it's not fair. You know, you did what you did and your mama did what she did, but I don't owe y'all shit for that. You know, I'm not your woman. These aren't your kids. I appreciate everything y'all have done, but I don't owe you anything, sir. Like, the fuck? And it's not a question. That's not what makes you good enough to be with me. That's not how any of this works. And that's not fair. You know, so like men be tripping. Like he's basically trying to say to her, like, I should be good enough for you because I've done all that. No, nigga, that's not how any of that works. The fuck you thought, you know? So I'm like, yeah, I just don't think that's fair. I don't feel like that's fair. Hold on. Okay. Okay. All right. Sorry, y'all. I knew I should have waited before I went live because business. Okay. All right. Life is life, and y'all. Thank you for bearing with me. This is a whole live stream, so stuff happens. I'm sure the new folks here are like, what the hell is she doing? All right. Here we go. All right. I know I didn't mean to make it seem like I'm ungrateful. That's not what I meant. I'd just like to tell him I'm 20 years old. You'll be 21 soon, Bash stated, and I'm hoping to throw my fiance a party. I can't do that if no one in your family knows you're engaged. You're not even wearing your ring. See, that's that bullshit. You, being a proper Brit, should have fucking asked her father for her hand in marriage before you got down on your rusty ass knee, old Ritz cracker colored ass nigga. Don't try to fucking browbeat her into and guilt trip her into some bullshit when your funky ass didn't even follow the proper protocol call. And your ugly ass mama should have been the one, since she got all these rules, policies, and procedures, you know, ways of governing yourself accordingly. She should have told you, son, don't do this shit without asking her pappy first. Bitch ass nigga. Anyway. Morgan glanced down at her bare finger. I wear it, Bash, she said defensively. Do you even want me here, Mo? He asked. Of course, Morgan shouted. I missed you, he said, pulling her into his arms, bending so that his lips were on her ear, kissing there. Did you miss me? I did. I did, she said. She closed her eyes, frowning. She didn't know who she was trying to convince, him or herself. She knew what it was like to miss someone. Messiah used to leave her for mere hours, and she counted every second until his return. Being away from him used to give her anxiety. She would be sick until his return. Hell, a meek had been out of her sights for 3 days, and it felt like months. It had been 2 weeks since she'd seen Bash, and she had felt nothing. In fact, she had been relieved to have some separation, some distance, because she had been able to be herself. It wasn't that she didn't love him. She did. He was a great friend to her. But that all-consuming love that had seized her heart with Messiah didn't exist with Bash. She wouldn't allow it to. That type of love left you broken. It led to dark places, and Morgan wanted to be in control of her heart this time around. She held back and resisted Bash every step of the way. She was lucky he was around at all. His patience was a show of his infatuation for her. His hand flirted with the hem of her dress. Morgan cuffed his wrist, stopping him. Bash, she whispered. I know celibacy. I know. I take it that ends when I make an honest woman out of you, he asked. Nigga, she already an honest woman. Fuck you mean? Like, what the hell is he talking about? Like, I hate that shit. Make an honest woman out of somebody. You don't need to be tied to a man to be an honest woman. Like, what type of bullshit is that? You raggedy dick nigga, you. Fuck you. He probably got a fucking gherkin anyway. Anyway, sorry. It ends when it ends, Bash, she answered. Damn, Morgan, it's been 2 years, he said in frustration. You act like I can't touch you. You can't. I don't like the shit, okay? I was raped, Bash. Raped by two niggas, and I couldn't even say no. I can say no now, and it's gonna continue to be no until I feel like fucking saying yes, she shouted. She closed her eyes and drew in a deep breath because she hadn't meant to divulge so much. She had wanted to scream it since the very first time he had tried his hand at her 2 years ago. Shock wore him. I didn't know, Mo, he said, reaching for her. She snatched her arm out of his grasp. I'm sorry. I'm dead wrong. You're just beautiful. I love you, and it seems like you're holding that back from me. I just want to know you, experience every part of you, make love to my future wife. The speech didn't move her even a little because even if she were game, making love was the last thing she wanted to do. What Morgan Atkins had been introduced to was sexual liberation. It was wild and free and passionate. Messiah had pulled an orgasm out of her a dozen different ways, and every single time, Morgan was left weak. She doubted that Bash could follow that act, and she wasn't in a rush to find out. She had no clue how she was supposed to be his wife if she couldn't stomach the thought of him inside her. Guilt weighed on her because she knew he wasn't the man she was supposed to marry. Bash was a great man. His kindness was remarkable. His ability to accept her children as his own, his ability to accept her with all her flaws. But Morgan struggled with love. She loved him, yes, but to fall in love with someone again, to give her mind, body, and soul to a man and trust him to keep it safe, it felt foolish. It felt risky because she knew what was at stake, her sanity. She was wrong and she knew it. Dangling intimacy in front of Bash like he were chasing a carrot, stringing him along when she knew he deserved more. Maybe I should just get it over with. Maybe after the first time with someone else, it'll get easier. Me, it was easier. I let him touch me without thinking twice. I'm sorry, she whispered. Don't apologize, Bash said. I didn't know that sex was associated with pain for you. I didn't know, Mo. Now she felt like an even bigger piece of shit because Bash was being understanding. He was being the good guy. He was being the perfect guy. He was the perfect guy. In every way since the day they had met, he had treated her like she was golden. He was everything a woman could ask for in a man, but her first love had been a gangster. He had been a menace and had helped her develop a taste that a good guy couldn't satisfy. Morgan craved a bad boy. Bash didn't even have a teaspoon's worth of street in his makeup. I'm an asshole, she thought. Stop, she whispered. She walked up to him and placed her hands around his neck as she looked up at him. You're right. It's been 2 years. I've been unfair to you, she admitted. Maybe we can take a trip this weekend. Aria wants me to dance with Stiletto Gang in Vegas. Stiletto Gang? Bash interrupted. The disdain that dripped off those two words put Morgan on the defensive. Tension filled his shoulders and his brow dipped. I don't know if that's the most tasteful look, Mo. I thought you decided to take a step back from that. No, Mo shot back. Your mother decided that I should take a step back for a while, and I never agreed. It's just been busy. I've been busy with the twins, with ma'am, and school, but I'm not a bit as busy now. Graduation is in a few weeks. Classes are over. Ethic and Alani will keep the twins. I have no excuse not to do what I love. Morgan, my family's name is not my name yet, Bash, and if you ever want it to be, I have to have freedom, Morgan argued. I don't like it, Morgan, he pressed. Morgan pulled back, frowning as a hand went to her hip. You act like I'm stripping, Bash. When we met, I was gang. You knew that I danced. You're headed to medical school, Mo, and you want to taint your image? You want to have your face all over social media, dancing on stage with hardly any clothes on, and then walk into a hospital to apply for an internship? You really think that's wise? Pause. He got shit fucked up because, excuse me, what the fuck does your internship, and it's actually called a residency, you dumb motherfucker? You can walk in there having been a stripper, and that shit means nothing. Don't nobody give a fuck about that shit. Are you smart enough? Do they want your ass as a part of their residence program? That's the question. The fuck is he talking about? Don't nobody give a fuck about none of that. Like this boy, this is dumb. Anyway, he was making sense, too much sense, and Morgan hated it. Fine, I won't do it. But we could still go. We could go to Vegas and support Aria and spend some time together. We could try to, she paused and shrugged. We can do it there. Get a dope suite, order some room service, have a few drinks, and let things go where they go. His brow softened, and she could see him considering it. Yeah, Mo, we can go support your friend, he said. Yay, she screamed in excitement. I'm so excited. She jumped up and down like a little girl, clapping her hands together before planting a kiss to his cheek. But first, I need to go spend time with my babies. I've never been without them for that long. Going 4 days will feel like torture. So bring them, Bash said. To Las Vegas? She asked, frowning. I don't know. I mean, I've never been, but that just doesn't seem like a good place for kids, and the flight is 4 hours. I don't think that's the best idea. They've been flying back and forth to London since they were born. I think they can handle a quick 4 hours, Bash said. We've been apart for 2 weeks. It'll be nice for the four of us to spend a few days together. We can find something appropriate for them to do. As long as we're all together, that's all that matters to me. Morgan softened. He really was such a good guy. Okay, she agreed. They can come. Bash kissed the side of her head and promised me you won't dance. I'm cool with you supporting your friend and all, but you on stage is a no-go. A tight-lipped smile was all the agreement she could muster. At least she was going. At least she wouldn't miss the experience completely. She would be there rooting Aria on. That would just have to be good enough. Her phone buzzed and Morgan opened her notifications. She unlocked her phone and a snicker of amusement fell from her lips at first glance. Morgan's King 810 instead of Murder King 810. Better? With a question mark. That was his message. She smirked, shaking her head. Men were so good at flirting behind the veil of anonymity. She would bet her bottom dollar that this man wasn't so confident in person. Cute, real cute. You're still corny. Morgan smiled and shook her head, surprised that she felt the unsettling in her gut that told her she was flattered. A stranger online makes me feel more excited than the man I'm about to marry. She had no idea that the stranger wasn't so strange at all. He was better acquainted with her than anyone else had ever been before. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. I don't even know what to say. Okay. I'm so mad at Bash with his funky ass, you weird ass. Oh, stick up your ass, nigga. You acting like you got the right to be telling her any fucking thing. You ain't got the right to tell her nothing. And she can dance gang gang if she want to. The fuck? Who you think you are, homeboy? Listen, oh, bothered, y'all. This man got me twisted all up in a slip knot, and I ain't even his bitch. Oh, have mercy. All right, let me keep going, child. Chapter 16. The hustle and bustle of the Aria Hotel and Casino was pure chaos as Morgan stood holding on to her twins' hands. She sat off to the side, waiting for Bash to check into their room. But after a long flight, the twins were bursting with energy. Sorry, come here, baby, she said, while simultaneously fumbling with Yara in her arms. Yara was crying. Her snotty nose and watery eyes had made a handkerchief of Morgan's Versace silk skirt. Or shirt, rather, sorry. Yara, baby, she said to herself as Yara twisted and turned in her arm, throwing a temper tantrum. Morgan looked around for a place to sit. Masari, come, baby. She headed for the seating area and sat Yara down. She got on her knees in front of her daughter as Masari slid next to his sister. Yali Pop, what's wrong? She signed. Is it your ears? Do they hurt? What's wrong, Yali Pop? Masari signed too. Masari leaned in and kissed Yara's ear, and Morgan smiled. She loved how he loved on his sister. Yara continued to cry, yelling so loud that people stopped to stare as they passed by. Yali, Morgan moaned. She knew the pressure from flying was worse for Yara, and she hoped this didn't last all day. Morgan turned for a split second, checking Bash's place in line. There were still 10 or so people in front of him. When she turned back to her twins, only one sat there. Yara, she shouted as she turned, her heart dropping. She panicked instantly. Yali Pop, she was calling out of instinct because it would do no good. Yara couldn't hear her. When she saw a Meek stroll through the crowd carrying her daughter, Morgan breathed a sigh of relief, but a different type of anxiety settled into her heart. I think I have something that belongs to you, he said. Issa and Aria came through the door next, and they all huddled in a small crowd. What's up, homie? Meek greeted, bending down to extend his hand to Masari. Sup, Masari shouted back. Issa scooped him. Her babies in the arms of the crew made her stress lessen some. She now had eight arms. Help. She now had help to manage them while Bash checked in. Morgan tried to retrieve Yara from Amik's arms, But Yara pulled away and rested her head against Amik's chest. His shirt became the next victim to her runny nose. "Amik, she's ruining your shirt," Morgan said. "A little snot never hurt nobody," he said. He leaned back and swiped her nose with his thumb. "Or a lot of snot," he chuckled. Yara shook her head, protesting as he tried to clean her face, rubbing the snot across his chest as she turned to the other side. "Yup, Yollipop, fuck it all up," he said. Morgan smiled and then leaned to grab baby wipes from her bag. She gripped the sides of Yali's cheeks with one hand, then cleared her nose with the other. She grabbed another wipe and lifted his free hand to clean that as well. The coarseness of his skin, the way he gave her fingers a discreet squeeze, Morgan's insides liquefied. Her entire face turned red. "I'm sorry," she said. "Don't worry about it," he answered. "Mm-hmm." They took a few steps away from Aria and Issa. "What are you doing here, Amik?" she asked. "I've got business. Issa and I out here. Aria said you weren't coming, Mo. I heard you. I'll keep my distance," he said. She nodded. "Thank you." It came out in a whisper because it was the most ridiculous thing she had ever shown gratitude for. Distance from him was torture. Even standing here with him, holding her daughter at his side with bags at their feet like they had traveled here together, made her knees go weak. She was wound so tightly that Amik could see it. "Hey," he said. "Relax, love. We're good. I understand your position, Mo. I hold no resentments." Bash's timing couldn't have been worse. He walked up carrying their room key. "Me, right?" he asked. He held out his hand. "Good to see you again, man." Morgan tensed because Amik's eyes held some animosity. His entire body stiffened and Yara popped her little head up because Morgan was sure his chest had turned to steel. He was staring at the man who had the girl he wanted. His eyes said so much. Clown ass nigga. The audacity that it was Bash stopping him from having her. He pulled his bottom lip into his mouth, biting hard, before meeting Morgan's worried stare. To act anything but cordial would raise questions. He didn't give a fuck, but it was clear that Morgan did. For a second time, he took the high road. No handshakes this time, however, just a nod of acknowledgement, barely a greeting at all. "You ready?" Bash asked, slapping the key card against the palm of his hand. Morgan nodded and then forced a protesting Yara from Amik's hands. Her skin touched his briefly and Morgan's mind went numb. He felt it too. She knew he did because he looked at her like he was in shock as he passed Yara off to her. A look of envy creased his brow when she passed Yara to Bash before grabbing Masari from Issa. "I'll see you later," she said to Aria. "Don't be late. We go on at 10, Aria said. "About that," Mo said. "I can't perform. I'm just coming to support." "Mo!" Aria protested. "Aria, I can't," she whispered. Quick feet carried her to Bash's side as they headed for the elevator bank. She glanced over her shoulder because she couldn't help but to look back. But Amik was gone, and Morgan felt a churning in her soul that told her she was walking next to the wrong man. And there's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. This nigga here. Okay, hold on, y'all. Okay, let me do this right quick.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Marva, for the Cash App, darling. Thank you so much. I appreciate you. All right. Okay. I don't even understand why she is allowing this man to run her life like this, because I feel like if this is some bullshit. I really do. I don't even know what to say. Hey, well, first, Hashitashi Grasshopper. Hey, learning. Welcome, darling. She said, stopping through to say, hey, girl, hey, in a meeting. Okay, thank you for being in the clouds, darling. I appreciate you. Thank you. Hope you like the video too, child. All right. Morgan walked into the arena carrying Masari on one hip. Bash trailed her with Yara. "We're late," she said. "Hari's gonna kill me. First I bail on her, now I'm not even here on time." "You didn't bail on her, Mo. You're in a different place in your life than she is." "Dancing isn't your priority," he said, trying to soothe the guilt Morgan had been expressing all day about backing out of the show. The twins shouldn't even be out this late. They wouldn't have to be if you didn't insist on coming. You don't have to babysit me. I told you I wouldn't go on stage, Morgan said, as they maneuvered through the back entrance with the passes Aria had left at the front desk. Now, see, I was thinking that she was going to leave him at the hotel with the babies, right? And then she could get on stage and dance with Stiletto Gang. But this bitch-ass nigga brings his funky punk ass to the club with her. No, God. If I was her, I would go on stage anyway. Like, what is he thinking? He is such a dingleberry. Oh, my God. I'm not babysitting. I'm just showing love, he said. Morgan rolled her eyes as she made her way towards Stiletto Gang's dressing room. As soon as she pushed through the metal door, she heard Aria yelling, I don't care what the contract says. You can't make someone perform, Aria shouted. She didn't sign it. I did. We only paid top dollar because we thought we would have both principal dancers of Stiletto Gang. We need you both. Our crowd is expecting more money on stage tonight, the promoter said. Morgan frowned as she stepped up to the conversation. What's going on? She asked white boy Nick, who leaned against the wall. Your ass is what's going on, he shot back. Is this about me? Morgan stepped up next to Aria. We book you both. We need you both. The rest of Stiletto Gang is good, but they're just backup. Who's backup, baby? Your mama's backup. I'm a motherfucking star, white boy Nick interjected. The promoter swiped a hand of frustration over his face. Look, no shade, but I need the two of you on stage. The artist paid for the both of you. And on top of that, we promised the fans an encore performance with Just Gang, the promoter explained. I have my kids with me. I can't go on stage. Do you see what I have on? Morgan defended. I'll let y'all work it out, but either under the contract or don't perform at all. You've got about a half hour to decide. An exasperated Aria turned to Morgan. Mo, I know you aren't going to make me beg. Shit like this gets out. I signed a contract. If I don't fulfill my end of this, we won't be able to secure a show for months. My name is all I have. I promise them you. They can't make you dance, Mo, Bash said over her shoulder. And you can't tell her not to dance. Only reason she even canceling is because of you, Bash, Aria snapped. I don't have clothes, Aria, Morgan said. Bitch, it's a dressing room full of shit to choose from, Aria countered. Morgan handed Masari the Bash. I thought we talked about this, Mo. Do I really have a choice at this point? She asked, shrugging. It's just one performance. She followed Aria into the dressing room, and before Bash could follow, Aria stopped him, putting her arm across the door to stop him from entering. You and the twins can wait backstage to watch the show, she said, pointing down the hallway. She's performing. Live with it. She slammed the door, and Morgan smiled at her through the reflection of the mirror she stood in front of. Gang, gang, bitch, Aria smirked. Gang, gang, Mo replied. Kumbaya, motherfuckers. Hurry up, Powerpuff Girls. We get it. You defeated the lame-ass, overbearing, insecure fiancé, Nick clapped his hands together. Chop, chop, we got a stage to burn down. All right, and there's a break in the chapter. I'm so glad. Because that fucking dude, child, he is trash with his weird ass and then his overbearing ass mammy. Anyway. Gang, 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 gang. Morgan's heart was like a drum. She heard it in her ears, beating, creating a cadence, building an anxiety inside her as she looked out over the crowd in front of her. There were so many people. Too many people. Never had it been this many people watching her. She felt like she would pass out. 2 years ago, she would have eaten this stage alive. She would have anticipated the beat drop and waited arrogantly for the music to feed her soul. 2 years ago, she had Messiah in the crowd watching, and whenever he was there, no one else existed. She danced for him, pictured him, only him, and her nerves faded. Now all she saw was a room full of strangers, and they terrified her. The lights above the stage blinded her, and the crowd was cloaked in darkness. Flashes from cell phone cameras went off one after another. Morgan stood, frozen, paralyzed, unarmed as her insecurities ate away at her. She slipped a finger in the nude one-piece bodysuit, snapping it against her thighs. She might as well have been naked. The color of the bodysuit matched her skin perfectly, and the cut was so seductive she was serving side boob and high thigh. She wished she had shorts to cover her weight gain. Her thighs were thick and busting through the nude fabric of her fishnet stockings. She wasn't Lil Morgan anymore. Twin babies had put 25 pounds on her frame. A dancer's frame was now a stripper's dream. Shorty Doo-Wop was stacked, but she was so insecure she didn't even feel like she belonged on a stage anymore. She hadn't stepped into Mo Money's dancing stilettos in 2 years. The little club performances didn't count. That was for fun. This was big business, and if she missed one count, she would ruin Stiletto Gang's reputation. Most days, she wore sneakers and leggings with toddler puke accenting a matching sweatshirt. No way did she belong on this stage. She had her hands full. How Aria had talked her into this performance, she had no idea. A moment of temporary insanity, she thought. Hey, yo, Morgan heard the call through the crowd. Her neck snapped to the side and her eyes found him instantly. Amik stood backstage next to Issa. And when their eyes met, he put two fingers to his forehead in salute. It was like he could read her body language, like he knew that she was nervous despite her most valiant efforts to pretend otherwise. His acknowledgement erased her insecurities. That hollow feeling in her belly hardened some. Amik, behind her, watching, encouraging, put a bit of moxie in her spine. She hadn't known he would be there, but she was glad he had decided to come. She put her hands on her hips. The beat dropped and Morgan turned the fuck on. Broke up with that nigga. He had me stressing. I was taught to turn my losses into lessons. Morgan's 16 count was so dope that Aria went crazy beside her. She jumped up and down, waving the Machino scarf in her hand like a helicopter above her head. Morgan Atkins was gone. Old Money was in the building. Bitch, Aria yelled. Aria grabbed a mic from the DJ. Hey, she said. The entire crowd joined her in hyping Mo up. Morgan took off like Aria was Phil Jackson and she was Kobe in the fourth quarter. Mo forgot about all insecurities. Those nude-colored shorts might as well have been invisible because the way her ass was moving had everyone in the crowd bothered. Morgan was dancing so hard the sweat dripped everywhere. Her mouth curled up in an arrogant sneer. She felt these words, felt this beat. Fucked up for a minute. Now I'm back to flexing. Morgan smiled and lifted her head to the sky as she lifted her hands, opening them wide like energy was entering her body. This felt amazing. It felt like her identity was back, like she had forgotten who she was for 2 years in this stage. This crowd was reminding her, I run up my haters, going ghost. I hope God don't let me do the most. Morgan brought praying hands to her chin and bounced them there before one hand went to her hip and the other in the sky like she held that Machino scarf. Roll. Mo turned to the back and the crowd roared because they knew what was next. Twerk. Out of nowhere, her babies bolted onto the stage and Morgan smiled as Masari began dancing. The crowd turned up higher. It was the cutest thing anyone had ever seen. Aria laughed and joined Masari as Morgan picked up Yara. She took her daughter to the speakers. She knew that Yara couldn't join in until she felt the subwoofers. She placed Yara's hand on the speaker and then did a bop to the beat while her daughter smiled. Morgan took her back center stage and put her down. And Yara took off, dancing with her brother under the bright lights. Mo Money, everybody. Stiletto Gang in this bitch. White boy Nick skipped back out onto the stage along with the other dancers. And they all formed a circle around Sari and Yara, clapping, dancing, and encouraging them as they danced. Morgan had never received love like this. The crowd was on another level when she picked up Yara as Aria grabbed her son. They waved. Say hi, Morgan signed to Yara. Yara waved shyly, then hugged her mother's neck, overwhelmed. Masari, on the other hand, ate up the spotlight, waving and blowing kisses to the crowd. Such a charmer. Morgan retreated backstage to their dressing room where Issa and Amik sat waiting. The fuck? Them babies murdered everything, Issa said, laughing as he lifted a styrofoam cup to his lips. He grabbed Aria, pulling her into him roughly. You need to go make a couple of them. I want two like yesterday. Fucking dancing ass twins. Cute ass motherfucking kids, he snickered. Morgan hollered. Where's Bash? How did they even end up on stage? She asked. Corny ass nigga left, Issa said. He left my babies backstage and walked out? Morgan asked, eyes narrowing into slits. Morgan rushed to her bag and dug through it until she found her phone. She held Yara on one hip and put the phone to her ear. Have you lost your mind? Why would you leave them backstage alone? What the fuck were you thinking? Morgan screamed the words as her heart raged. Her eyes burned. She was a crier. Whenever she was angry, she cried, and she hated it in this moment. I didn't plan to go on stage. It just happened. That doesn't fucking excuse the fact that you left my kids alone backstage around motherfuckers they don't even know. She paused as Bash responded. All eyes were on her, but she didn't care. She closed her eyes and took a deep breath. Oh, now you want to come back to get them. Don't bother. Morgan ended the call and tossed her phone on the vanity in front of her. She rushed into the bathroom. Yara's hands on her face, then her little lips on her cheek reminded Morgan to breathe. She hugged her daughter. She knew that Yara processed everything. She soaked up other people's energy, and Mo didn't want her to feel anything other than peace. She sat on the sink and sighed. Mommy is okay. You did so good, Yollipop. You danced so beautifully. Thank you, Mommy, Yara signed. Morgan smiled. Yara was so intelligent, so sharp. She was learning her signs at record pace, and Morgan was so proud to be her mother. A knock at the door interrupted them, and Morgan pulled a paper towel from the dispenser, wetting it. 1 second, she called out. She blotted her face. It was still red from crying, but she couldn't hide in the bathroom forever. She lifted Yara and snatched open the door. Amik stood there, brow knitted in concern, eyes locked in on hers. Good? He asked. She nodded. Words, Mo. If you're good, tell me you're good. If you ain't, all it takes is a word in his handle, he whispered. You know that. Morgan sighed in relief. How could he leave them? They were fine, Mo. They were safe, Nick stated, eyes on them at all times. They were standing in the threshold that separated the bathroom from the dressing room. He was keeping her there until he saw her worry dissipate. Fuck that nigga, Mo. Tonight's about you. You're a fucking star, love. And you shined. The twins, too, he snickered. He pulled out his phone and held it up for Mo to see. You're everywhere, love. Niggas is spreading love. Don't let anybody dim that light. A popular gossip account had reposted a clip of Mo's performance. She was going viral. She smiled. Yara leaned lazily against Morgan's cheek and groaned as a big yawn left her mouth. I gotta get them to bed, she whispered. Can you drop me at the hotel? Yeah, whatever you need, Mo, he said as he stepped aside. You okay? Aria asked. Morgan nodded. I'm fine. I'm gonna get the kids back. I'll catch up with you when we get back, okay? Do you want to stay in my suite tonight? Aria asked. Morgan shook her head. I'm fine, she said. Aria stood, removing a key card from her purse. She handed it to Mo, just in case he's on some bullshit and you don't feel like arguing. Won't be no arguing, Amik stated. Aria jerked her neck back. Okay, Amik, step in, she instigated. Morgan took the room key anyway and gave Aria a departing hug. She hugged Issa too, then walked out with Meek, who carried Masari. His hand to the small of her back acted as a guide until they were outside. He didn't speak. Neither did she, but Masari was full of conversation. Hey, you, look! Masari pointed to the fountains across the street. The Bellagio was beautiful at night, and Masari was fully invested in the waterworks going off in the distance. His name is Meek, sorry. Can you say Meek? Masari nodded. Look, Meek! I'm wookin', homie, Amik answered, chuckling. Go see, Masari said, turning Meek's head in the direction of the show. I guess we're going to see the fountains, Meek said. Morgan sighed. It's late and I'm barely dressed. I'm wearing stage clothes. Yeah, we need to talk about that too, Mo. Really fucking showing out. Got me ready to put the burner to a nigga out here, he said. You know what you do. Morgan snickered as she watched him put Masari down and remove his jacket. He placed it around her shoulders, then leaned to grab Masari's hand. Come on, Mommy, Masari said. Yeah, Mommy, come on, Meek instigated. Morgan looked at Yara. You want to see the fountains? Morgan signed. Yara nodded, sleepy, but Mo knew she would last. She sighed, adjusted the jacket, and walked beside Meek. They took the bridge across Las Vegas Boulevard, and Masari took off running as fast as his little legs would carry him. Meek took off after him, scooping him, then tossing him so high into the air that Morgan's heart tensed in worry. Meek caught him effortlessly, then placed Masari on his shoulders. He held onto Masari's legs to keep him secure. Morgan smiled as she caught up. Don't do that, Meek said. Do what? She asked. Fake smile, he stated as they found a spot in the center to watch the show. Morgan turned her eyes to the man-made lake in front of the hotel. I just don't want to fight with him, she whispered. But I want to dance, too. I want to dance with Stiletto Gang. So dance, Mo, he said. Medical school will be there if you choose to pursue it later. No offense, but I don't want a doctor working on me that don't love medicine. You're supposed to be passionate about saving lives like you are about being on stage. I guess, she said, shrugging. She hoisted Yara up on her hip. She's not going to make it until the next show. Yara's little eyes were closing, and he took her from Mo's hands. They'll run every few minutes or so, he said. I've got her. Come on, Mommy. Sorry, Morgan said, pulling Masari off Meek's shoulders and placing him on his feet. He was fine. I can handle your babies, Mo, he said. I can see that, she answered, amazed at how good with them he truly was. A smile melted on her face. Don't do that either, he said. What now, she asked. The real smile stops my heart, Morgan Atkins. Bring the fake shit back. Morgan's entire body warmed. She leaned her head on his shoulder. You make me feel, She stopped speaking and sighed. She couldn't finish that sentence, and she was grateful when he didn't push. Look, Mommy, Masari shouted. The fountains erupted, and Morgan reached for her daughter, who was sleeping against Meek's chest. Look, Yollipop. Yara turned to the lights, then turned her head in the opposite direction, going right back to sleep. Okay, Yara was like, man, fuck that water. Seen one water, seen them all. Seen one water droplet, seen them all. Amik laughed with Mo as she picked up Masari to give him a better view. Wow! Morgan loved his excitement. Meek did too. He smiled more than Morgan had ever witnessed before as he watched Masari's reactions. When it was over, Masari reached for Mo and nestled on her shoulder. Do you feel like walking back? I know your car is in valet at the club, but it's cool, Mo. We can walk. It's whatever you want to do. They strolled down the lively street, laughing and talking. Mo wasn't in a rush to get to the drama. She stopped to stroll through the different hotels along the way. It took them 2 hours to walk a half mile. She didn't even care that her feet were aching. Her soul was glowing. You're staying here, right? She asked. He nodded. I'm in 2514. I'll walk you to your suite. Make sure you and the twins are good. Morgan shook her head. That's not necessary, Meek. You're going to carry 2 sleeping toddlers upstairs by yourself? He asked. He headed toward the elevators before she could even respond. Yara stirred in his arms as they stepped inside, and he placed a comforting hand on her back, rubbing gently, then patting as he bounced a little. Morgan swooned. You're going to make some girl very happy one day, Amik. You're a beautiful man, Morgan sighed, shaking her head. Meek's brow lifted and amusement played in his eyes. I've been called a lot of shit before, Mo. And ain't shit nigga, that nigga, daddy, but never that. Never beautiful. He chuckled. I don't know if I like that too much. One of those real smiles that he hated blessed her face. He stood next to her, leaning against the back of the elevator. Now that, he said, looking at her lips, that smile, that's beautiful. She blushed. Me, I'm a real nigga. Yup, she agreed, a real beautiful ass nigga. He hollered, and she shared in the laughter. 2 sleeping babies didn't stop them from gravitating to each other. Morgan turned to him and he leaned down, a moth to a flame. Morgan knew she was flying toward danger and still her eyes closed. I can't breathe, Meek, she whispered, their lips so close, his breath so sweet. She waited for the kiss. Her body was going haywire, her insides malfunctioning, screaming, can I kiss you, Mo? He whispered. He was so close that he was already kissing her. The movement of his lips as he spoke the words caused their lips to grace in the slightest way, a match that set her soul on fire everywhere. The word was so airy he barely heard it. One hand was occupied by a toddler and he wished it were free because he wanted to do things with it. He had plans for that hand. One would have to do. A fist to her hair and a slight pull craned her neck back. Morgan withered under his command. He was so aggressive, so rough. She loved it. Child, I know you do. His lips barely graced hers as Yara stirred, crying, and on cue, the slightest whimper from his sister awakened Masari every time. 2 toddlers, tired and screaming, interrupted them. Morgan pulled back and the doors opened. Morgan stepped out. When Amik went to follow, she stopped him. No, you... Morgan stumbled, panicking, as she maneuvered out of his hold and held out a hand to keep him at arm's distance. No, Meek. No, she whispered. She put Yara on her feet and took Masari from Meek's arms. Morgan, Amik, if we keep playing, if we keep pretending like this is just friendly, just to make ourselves feel better, we're going to go too far, she whispered. He held the elevator door open. Too far for who? He asked. For everyone, she shouted that part. Her twins were whining, pulling at her, crying. Mo, let me help you, he said, reaching for her son. Morgan snatched his hand. Amik, I can't take it there. I just can't. And you're literally everything I want, but I can't. And if I keep pretending like we're just friends, if you keep coming around with Issa or if I keep coming with Aria, I'm going to... She paused as she shook her head. She didn't even know what Meek saw in her. She came with hella baggage. She was holding on to her baggage at this very moment, and that was only the baggage that could be seen. The emotional baggage was heavier. It was impossible for someone else to carry. She could barely handle it herself. You're gonna what? He pushed. Fuck you. I'm gonna fuck you, Meek. You're gonna turn me into a whole hoe, and I don't wanna be a hoe. I'm already a little hoeish for the shit you did to me at your loft. I don't wanna be a whole hoe. Right now, I'm half a hoe, and I need to keep some self-respect. Listen, the motherfucker struggle is real, you heard me? Morgan is struggling. Oh, Lord. Listen. No, God. We'd have been going to room 2514. Put the babies on the couch, child. I'm sure it's a let-out couch. It's a suite. Fuck out of here. Baby, knock the cobwebs off my spine. Fuck what you heard. This child is bullshit. I don't even motherfucking understand. I'm not into denying myself a motherfucking thing. If I want to be spanked, spank me, daddy. If I want to be choked, choke me, daddy. Listen, if I want to be tied up, handcuffed, blindfolded, ball gag in my mouth, all types of shit going on. That's what I want. Give it to me. The fuck? Why are you going to be denying yourself of some shit? Hell, riding crops and knock. Fire cuffing. I'm with the shit. Bring it all. Like, stop playing. Don't rotate and play with it. Don't fuck around and find out why. No, God. Mm-mm. Anyway, I thought I saw somebody come tiptoeing in here real quiet. Like, there she go. Hey, Love Muffin. Hey, Kim Bird. How are you, darling? Thank you so much for being here, lovey. Welcome. I knew I saw her here. Listen, hello, KTG. Welcome. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Child, I hope you're old enough to be listening to this because oh, Lord, I got to go age restricted. You heard me? Because listen, no, God. Okay, Kim Cash said, I understand. You got to remember, she is in a so-called relationship, so she's not trying to be a ho-ho. Child, listen, fuck that. That ain't no relationship. That's some bullshit. That's pressure. That's what she's in. She's under pressure. That's what she's under. Shit, that's not a relationship. That damn ring on her finger feels like a noose, which is why she doesn't wear it. Anyway, Meek couldn't hide his amusement as he finessed his shin. She was throwing a fit and he found it completely fucking adorable. If she was trying to convince him not to pass go, she was failing miserably. Morgan slapped his chest. It's not funny, she whined. He snickered. It kind of is, Mo. Shit's fucking hilarious. She laughed too, shaking her head. The elevator began to ding repeatedly from being held up. Good night, Mo. No, good night, Mo said, pleading with him with just her eyes to walk away. Night, love, he answered. He pressed the button and the elevator closed. Morgan breathed a sigh of relief before leading her babies to her room. Where you been, Mo? Bash's voice was like nails on a chalkboard. Let me put the twins down, she said. He was on her heels as she took them to the bedroom. Your phone don't work? He pressed. Morgan turned abruptly. I'm not talking about anything until my kids are asleep, Bash. I just want to know where you were. Morgan could see that waiting wasn't an option. I was with Amik. After you left, the kids ran out on stage. Oh, I know. It's all over the internet. My mother called. Do you know how ridiculous this looks for my family? My fiance half naked on stage. My family's name is prestigious, Morgan. You have to think about everything you do before you do it. You act like I'm a stripper, Morgan shouted. He motioned to her clothes. Look at you, Morgan. You might as well be. Oh, nigga. That's me talking. That's not her. That's me. Girl, grab your shit, kick this nigga in the dick, take your babies to 2514, and tell this nigga to fuck smooth the fuck off. Oh, God. I done got warm. Can you turn the air down, please? And thank you. Morgan recoiled, jerking her neck back so hard that it hurt. She scoffed in disgust, shaking her head. I'm not staying here tonight, she said. I might not be staying with you at all. She reached for her suitcase and scooped Yara in her arms. Come on, Masari. Masari shimmied down off the bed, following Mo without question. Bash scooped him up. Put my fucking son down, Morgan shouted. You left him backstage with strangers. Don't be dramatic. Your friends were there, Bash said. You don't even know them. I know them. You don't, but you can get to know them real well if you keep trying me. Morgan had snapped. I'm not afraid of your little thugs from Flint. You've always been real easy to impress. I've given you access to the whole world, Mo, and you want to shake your ass on stage like you're for sale, Bash screamed. I wasn't watching that. So you left my children unattended? They're 2 years old. You left them because you were pissed that I chose to dance with Stiletto Gang. Nah, this is because I made a decision of my own for the first time in 2 years. I didn't do what you or your mother wanted me to do. I did what I wanted to, and you left me hanging. And now I'm a stripper? When you met me, I was dancing. You used to act real cool, real chill, Bash, like you was a good kid from around the way. Now I embarrass your family. Fuck you and fuck your family. Morgan released the bag and grabbed Masari from Bash's arms. Where are you going, Mo? I apologize. I should have. Morgan seated Masari on the top of the suitcase. Hold on for mommy, okay? I'm going to take you on a ride. It'll be fun, but you have to hold tight. She kissed his head and then leaned the suitcase forward onto two wheels. Mo, with one kid on her hip and dragging one on the piece of luggage behind her, she stormed out of the room. Morgan was so angry she couldn't even cry. She struggled with Yara and Masari and the luggage all the way down to Aria's room. She wondered if this was what it would be like if she left Bash, if she would struggle balancing it all, if she would drop the ball with her twins because they would be fatherless. How much easier things would be if they had a father. Morgan's lip trembled when she opened the door to the suite. She flicked on the light. Shit, Mo! Aria screamed, scrambling as she jumped off Issa. She was in the middle of a ride. Oh, sorry, Morgan sang as she dropped the luggage. Fuck you stop for? Mo know what dick look like? Keep going, Ali, Issa groaned. Morgan hurried her babies to the adjoining room as the soundtrack to Aria and Issa's escapade filled the entire suite. Mommy, what's that noise? Masari asked. Auntie Aria is being, Mo turned away from her son to open her luggage. Oh, she whispered to herself, chuckling. Her being a what, mommy? Masari asked. His little voice was so innocent, so curious. Morgan loved him. She looked at Yara, who, through all the fuss, was protected from the chaos because she couldn't hear it. Nothing, baby. She put headphones over his ears and changed them into pajamas as they watched their favorite cartoons. She took a special moment with Yara. I love you, Yara Ray. You are always enough. You are loved. No more, no less than sorry. You are equal, and I cherish you, Yali Pop. Do you love mommy, too? Morgan sighed, tears accumulating in her eyes. It was all she had wanted to hear as a child, and she made sure that Yara heard it every day. Yara signed, yes, mommy, I love you. They were asleep in minutes. Morgan's mind was all over the place. She tossed and turned because she was unable to turn off her thoughts. Thoughts of Bash filled her mind. Fantasies of a meek snuck in behind those. Then her fears. Fears of being alone. Fears of never finding love again. Fears of her children growing up the way she had without a father to call their own. It was the number one reason why she'd let things go with Bash this long. She loved her children, and for a long time, or sorry, he loved her children, and for a long time, that was enough. Her happiness didn't matter. Then Meek had come to London and messed everything up. He had made her feel those goddamn butterflies that her mother had told her about so long ago. Morgan had always been a hard-headed girl. She didn't run from them. She chased them because to her, the butterflies weren't a warning sign. They signified love. More than all else, Morgan Atkins wanted love. Morgan envied the rise and fall of her children's tiny chests. She envied their peace. She promised herself she would always keep them that way, at peace. Morgan showered, hoping that the steam would entice her to sleep, but it only awakened her more. She dressed, throwing on jeans and a white V-neck shirt. The pair of heels she danced in were all she had with her. They would have to do. I just need some air and some food, she thought. She crept out of the room and saw the glow from a laptop from the couch. Hey, Aria greeted. I didn't know you were still up. Are you okay? Morgan nodded. I'm fine. Just a bad argument with Bash. I'm sorry for interrupting, Morgan said. Hey, I need to clear my head. Do you mind watching the twins? They're asleep. They won't wake up. They normally sleep through the night. Yeah, no problem, Aria said. I'm in for the night. Mo nodded. Thanks. She grabbed her handbag and one of the room keys off the table before walking out the door. The casino floor was alive. Even at the late hour, she walked through the rows and rows of machines headed for the door. Out of the thousands of people in the building, she saw the one she wanted to avoid, Amik, standing at the craps table near the exit. She thought of turning around, of just going up to her room and calling it a night. But when his eyes glanced up, it was like he had sensed her. It was like someone had whispered in his ear and said, yo, bruh, there's Morgan. Morgan sucked in a deep breath and her feet carried her to his side. Hey, she greeted with a soft smile as she slid into the space next to him at the craps table. You look like you're getting lucky tonight. She nodded at the girl beside him and Meek smirked. Nah, I don't pay to play, he responded. Morgan squinted and peeked over at the beautiful woman in the fire red dress. She was nestled in tight beside Meek, who had a rack full of black chips in front of him. She was laughing, touching him lightly, whispering in his ear. Nothing about her screamed professional. Really? Morgan whispered. Really, Meek sniggered. She the type to get a nigga hemmed up out here. It's a price tag on that, Meek motioned toward the gang. You want to shoot something? Morgan shook her head. I don't know how, she said. Not in the mood. I'm just going to get some air. Mo, it's 1 a.m. You don't walk the strip by yourself this late, he said. Meek turned to the dealer standing over the colorful table. Color me up. Meek collected his chips and then led her to the cage of cashiers to retrieve his money. Risking $50,000 on a dice game like it's nothing, huh? Mo asked as they walked away. It is nothing, Meek answered. Morgan scoffed. Meek had come a long way. She remembered back in the day when she used to bend corners with Niche. She used to see him and the crew out on the block, tapping small dollars. Back then, she was sure every $20 bill counted. He had bossed up and she could tell. Demeanor, pockets, crown, all three were heavy. A Meek was a king. They stepped out into the desert air. Now, why are you awake? It's like 4 a.m. back home, Meek said. She folded her arms across her chest, shrugging. I had a fight with Bash, she admitted. He doesn't like when I'm on stage. When he met you, weren't you dancing already, he asked. My point exactly. I don't want to talk about him, though. She leaned her head on his arm as they strolled down Las Vegas Boulevard. Even in the middle of the night, it was alive. I know that's your man and all, but if he ever do anything out of order, he can get his tape pulled back real proper. Shit can get ugly over you. Anything, Morgan, and I'm dead fucking serious, Meek stated. Morgan lifted one side of her mouth in a half-hearted smile. He wouldn't. He's not that guy, but thank you, she said. A drunk girl stumbled into her, and Morgan grimaced as beer spilled all over her shirt. I'm so sorry, the girl said, an octave too loud and slurring. She reached for Mo's breast, trying to drunkenly wipe the wetness away with her bare hands. It's okay, Morgan said, lips pulled tight and forehead bent as she stepped toward the row of souvenir shops that lined the boulevard. Meek grabbed a tourist shirt, and Morgan shook her head. I guess that's what happens when you're the only sad and sober person on a strip. Can we go somewhere else, somewhere quiet? She turned toward the counter where Meek was paying for his items. Her eyes fell on a swimming suit hanging behind the cashier. We'll take those too, she said, pointing at the cheap matching two-piece bikini and swim trunks. A large and an XL. She grabbed 6 mini shots of Patron. These two. Who's swimming? Meek asked. Brows lifted in wonder. And tequila ain't good for a nigga, Mo. I get on another level off that shit. He smirked and shook his head. We're swimming and good, she said. Meek peeled off a $100 bill and grabbed the bag as Morgan led him back to their hotel. They bypassed the action in the casino and went to the back of the popular resort. Yo, Mo, it's closed. Who's in Vegas close at like 6, he said. That's why we're gonna sneak in, she answered. She grabbed the steel bars of the security fence. Help me up. You're a real thug, huh? He asked, smirking. You can smack a nigga, but you're afraid to bypass a tiny sign and a locked gate, she challenged. He shook his head and finessed the side of his face before bending down to create a bridge for her to put her foot in. He hoisted her up and over the gate before jumping it himself. Morgan peeled out of her clothes instantly, stripping down to her bra and panties. Meek's brow lifted and he glanced away, being polite, as Morgan changed into the two-piece swimsuit. She tucked her clothes inside the plastic bag and grabbed a towel from the towel stand. She opened one of the many bottles of tequila and tilted her head back as she drank it all. She grimaced as it heated her entire body. She reached for another and tossed it to Meek. Your turn. Get changed. I'll be in the hot tub, she said, walking into the darkness with a second shot in her hand. Palm trees lined the pool area and dim lights cast a small glow over the dark area. She pressed the button on the side of the massive hot tub and then slid her body inside. Her tension melted instantly. Morgan tilted her head back and wet her hair, then waited patiently for Meek to join her. Strong thighs and ugly feet are what she saw first as he approached. His body was incredible. His strong physique explained why he was able to break a nigga's jaw with one punch. He was disciplined, always had been. While Messiah and Issa ran around terrorizing the city, Meek was a strategist. He was a thinker. He plotted his moves from A to Z. He was the one the opposition never saw coming. Smooth ass a Meek. He slid into the hot tub. This feels amazing, she groaned. He threw his arms over the side of the hot tub and peered at her as bubbles filled the space between them. Yo, the twins on stage tonight was legendary, Meek said, snickering. The crowd went crazy. I still can't believe they belong to you. She beamed and shrugged. Yep, all mine. He shook his head. That body don't look like a body that housed twins, Mo, he returned. She smirked, blushing, before shrinking further into the water, up to her neck. He didn't know the insecurity she carried over the weight she'd gained, over the weight Christiana constantly encouraged her to lose. It felt great. They loved it. Yara was a little shy, but Masari, she snickered, shaking her head. That boy is a whole trip. He'll do anything. He's fearless. She knew where he'd gotten that spirit from. It was in his DNA to be kingly and not fear anything or anyone walking on two legs. He was his father's child, most saddened because things should have turned out so differently. Things could have been so beautiful. Once upon a time, they had been. Now it was just lonely. She wasn't living. She was just floating, being steered through life at someone else's direction. Morgan had never been so unhappy. Even years ago, when she was a little girl, things had been better because at least then she had her sister to confide in. Morgan felt alone. She was drowning in a sea of unfulfillment, except with Meek. He was like a life raft. He was like a breath of fresh air. Meek was like going home after being away and smelling your mama's favorite dish as soon as you walked through the door. He gave her a nostalgic feeling she would never forget, bringing out a side of her that had only existed for a short moment in time before she had suppressed it. He made her feel beautiful and strong and wild and free, like a butterfly. What you looking at, Mo? You looking but not talking. What's in your head? He asked. She shrugged. Just thinking. I go inside my head sometimes because I know if I spoke my thoughts, I'd seem ungrateful. You won't. So speak, he ordered. I mean, I have everything, every single luxury with Bash. I damn near live in a castle. His family's name will be not my name soon, and it's powerful. Money, influence. I'm about to graduate and start med school. My babies are beautiful and healthy. Ethic and Alani are happy. They support me through everything. Bella and Easy love on me, and I still feel like something's missing, like none of it is good enough. I'm not in love with him, Meek, and I'm about to marry him. I'm terrified. So do something about it, Meek shot back. I can't, she said, scoffing. She knew he wouldn't understand. No one understood. Hell, Morgan didn't even understand. She was simply a girl who had always needed a man to love her. First her father, then Ethic, then Messiah, on to Bash. She needed to pull strength from men, needed them to hold her up. Pause, and that's her fucking problem. Bash believed in her so much that it made her believe in herself. He was in a lot of ways her best friend. God. He's the perfect friend, but her husband, he was never meant to be. How he had snuck out of the friend zone and trapped her in his world, she didn't know, but Morgan felt like she was living behind the constraints of a glass wall because he came right in and took care of everything you needed. That's how they get you. That's how unattractive women get with good-looking dudes. They get them by being everything they need. Emotionally, physically, mentally, spiritually, they just fill in all the empty spots. And then you look up and it's been 35 years and 5 kids. And you're like, how the fuck did I give her? Because when the last kid leave the house, you like, I'm stuck in the house with this slow fucker. Because you hopefully grown up during that time, and now you looking at him, or he looking at you like, the fuck am I doing here with this nigga? Like, how the fuck did this even happen? So Morgan is getting a dose of reality rather early, and that's a good thing, though, because she don't need to marry this fool. Mm-mm. Child, please, that's another cage. A pretty one, all covered in diamonds and royalty. But still a fucking cage. And his mama wants some company in that fucked up cage. That's why she trying to get you there. So y'all can all live in the fucking castle together. And she can finally have another black woman to commiserate with. Fuck out of here. No God. Fuck you, ma'am. And your cage. Anyway. Like that royal palace was a prison. Like she was a pretty picture on display at a museum. And Bash wanted all his family and friends to come see his new art piece. You can, Mo. He's your kid's father, not your master. When you're ready to step, you let me know, Meek answered. What you gonna do, Meek, if I step, she asked. You ain't gonna step, so it don't matter, he snickered. Morgan bent her brows at him in offense. I'm about that life. Don't act like you never seen me act up, she said, rolling her eyes. He laughed at that. He remembered every single tantrum she'd ever thrown. He licked his lips and leaned his head back as he looked up into the night sky. He felt something hit his chest, and he lifted to see her coming across the hot tub. "Sorry," she laughed, fishing the mini Patron bottle she'd thrown at him out of the water. She twisted the top and held it to her lips, only taking half before lifting it to his mouth. "Open up." "You're trouble as fuck, Mo," he said. "I'm not. I'm a good girl, me," she answered. She sat beside him and turned to face him. "No lies told there," he said. "You love me, don't you?" she said playfully. "No lies told there either," he repeated. Morgan steeled, her heart, her words, her eyes on his. She couldn't breathe. "Meek, you're on the outside looking in. You don't know me enough to love me. You just see a pretty girl." "Everybody sees a pretty girl, Mo. That's the obvious. They probably even see the weak girl. I see the strong girl. I see the bitch in you, Mo, the part you keep tucked. But the fire that's trying to start that lives in the deepest part of you is flickering, and it just can't catch because you won't let it, but I see it." Little Morgan got the power to burn the whole damn kingdom down. There's a fire in you. You're a fighter, Mo. Morgan's eyes prickled. No one had ever described her that way. She didn't even see herself that way. How could he? How could he think she was strong? "You were in my life every day, Mo. Couldn't touch you. Couldn't have you, but you were there. You walked by me every day. I don't even know if you noticed how you stopped a nigga heart. I saw you smile every day, every fucking single day. The most beautiful girl I'd ever seen. That's hard on a nigga, being in your presence, but not being present. Putting all that in a box so I wouldn't do no disrespectful shit. You weren't mine. Any other nigga, I would have snatched you. But Messiah was my brother, and he needed you more. It just wasn't shit to be done. No moves to be made. You were with my nigga, so the shit I felt couldn't exist. I shut the shit down, but some of the shit that has run through my mind about you." Meek paused, shaking his head. "I have no business thinking about you like that." Morgan was speechless. She hadn't known that he felt like that back then. Even if she had, it wouldn't have mattered because at the time she only saw one man. But hearing the words from Meek now made her feel sick to her stomach. Morgan lifted out of the hot tub and sat on the edge. She gripped the lip of the cement and shook her head. "I'm not perfect, Meek. You only feel that way because you don't know the fucked up shit about me. I'm spoiled and selfish. I'm a handful." "Handful or not, your love, Morgan Atkins. Just looking at you right now is love. You and love, the same. It's just who you are. I feel the shit every time you place those fucking eyes on me. You just drive a nigga crazy. Have a nigga ready to air shit out if your smile dip even a little bit. Your smile dips around him, Mo, and my trigger finger starts itching. So like I said, when you ready to step, let me know." Morgan sucked in air, holding her breath at the conviction she heard in his voice. Morgan leaned back to get the bag that was within arm's reach. Another shot. She needed another shot. She tilted it to her lips, then Meek stood and walked between her thighs as she poured the rest into his mouth. She placed both hands on the side of his face, and her heart fluttered as he captured her in that gaze, in that dark place behind his eyes. "You gotta stop touching me, Mo." The way he said it, like he was struggling, like there was yearning in him, like the pads of her fingertips were unbearable to touch against his skin. His toned body lifted out of the water slightly, biceps flexed, abs tensed as he fisted her wet hair with one hand. He kept her there, trapped in his gaze, a breath away as he took in every inch of her face. Neither spoke. The tension in the air lay but her breath. She could hear her heart racing in her ear, and then he kissed her. He kissed her like he didn't need permission, like he knew she would consent. The tension between them had been building since London, and they both wanted to cross a line that a dead man had drawn in the sand. Morgan's body exploded. TNT, a fucking demolition erupted in her as her heart raced and their lips danced. She could feel years of wanting in this kiss. Fireworks, a full display, erupting one after another. Each time his full lips enveloped hers, they were soft and thick, and his tongue was skilled and sweet. Morgan moaned as her forehead collapsed in wrinkles and her back arched. Guilt, lust, desperation filled her as she opened her mouth, accepting it all again and again, because damn, a Meek tasted so good. He was dominant and strong and a whole fucking goon, and Morgan felt dizzy. His touch made her lightheaded. She was high, and it felt familiar. She hadn't realized how much she had missed being with a man in position until now. Different dog, same breed, aggressive. The type of man that has some bite behind his bark, and Morgan knew just how to tame him. He traveled down the inner state of her body, Lips everywhere, tongue everywhere, her neck. She gasped, a collarbone, a kiss, her sternum. Who the fuck kissed there? A meek kiss there before sliding a finger along the seam of her bikini top, peeling it back to reveal her taut nipple. A breath caught as he tasted there, pulling it into his mouth, circling once with his tongue before dipping farther. He was unafraid of her depths, unafraid of her wet. As he slid her bikini bottom to the side, Morgan's mind went to the tattoo that used to be there, Messiah's name. She had branded it because she had thought it would always belong to him. Tiny butterflies covered it now, but Morgan still felt like Meek could see behind them, like the butterflies were mad with invisible ink. I think she meant made with invisible ink. And Messiah's name was staring back at Meek. She tensed. He paused, kissing the face of her intimacy, and then placing steepled hands in front of him. "What are you doing?" she whispered. "A nigga like to bless his meal. Smooth ass." He looked up at her over his furrowed brow, eyes never leaving hers as he tasted her, his first sample, a long, flat tongue to her clit, pressed firmly, and then circles. "Ameek," she screamed, his tongue on her body melted her. He wrapped his hands around her ass and pulled her off the edge of the hot tub, surrounding his head with her thighs as he held the tiny fabric out of the way. He moaned like she was the best thing he'd ever tasted. She exploded instantly, his lips around her clit, pulling, flicking, as three fingers worked her middle, made stars glow behind her pinched eyes. Slurp, one long pull of her clit, finessing it out of the hood with just his tongue alone. Morgan's eyes popped open in ecstasy. All Morgan saw were the waves on the top of his head as it bobbed between her legs. She was seasick. She palmed his head with one hand as she placed the other behind her body for balance. Then she rolled her hips in his face, adding pressure, riding his tongue like she rode a dope beat. Morgan on the fucking offbeat. Old money on the tongue, slip and slide, down to ride on it for the one time. "Feed it to me, Mo," he whispered, pausing to kiss her inner thigh. Morgan had that pussy on a spoon for that nigga, and he was overindulging. He pressed a thumb to her clit and rotated clockwise. Morgan bucked as her legs opened wider. He groaned. "Lick. You got it." Morgan felt her entire body prickle, and she tensed. The phrase, it was too similar. "Yo, shorty, you got it." Common enough, but as soon as she heard it fall off Meek's lips, she thought of Messiah. "No, Meek, no," she whispered. She scrambled to her feet, dripping water and seduction all at the same time. Meek exited the hot tub. "Mo, no, this is a mistake," she whispered, wrapping the towel around her body. "What am I doing? God," her face contorted, her lips trembled, and shame filled her. "Mo, whoa, talk to me. I thought we were on the same page. I didn't mean to offend, love." He pinched his lips, the taste of her lingering there, simmering on his tongue like a concoction that needed time for the flavor to settle in. She was steeping on his tongue, and he licked his lips just to get another taste because it was the best he'd ever had. Morgan felt like she was falling apart. Her eyes burned so badly and her vision blurred with tears, she couldn't look at him, so she snatched her arm away and grabbed her clothes before rushing, damn near running away. She was terrified of what she was feeling. It wasn't right. How could she feel this for Meek? Morgan rushed into the hotel, putting as much distance as she could between herself and temptation because she wasn't sure what giving in would mean. And that's the end of that chapter. I'm sick of this bitch, too. What the fuck you running from it for? Who you running to, Ritz Cracker? What the fuck you running the ground cracker for? Nigga, he can't do it like Meek. And Meek ain't Messiah. Messiah's dead. Get over it. You better have juice all up his nose. Fuck what you heard. I'm trying to tell you how to get your groove on. The fuck? Okay. No, she don't need to move on from him, baby. Mm-mm. No, 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 no. Hold on, y'all. All right, sorry, y'all. Child, listen. Anyway, as I was saying, no, she need to have juice all up on up his nose, child. He need to be drowning on. Hey, Love Jones. Oh Lord, I'm so fucking ignorant. All right. What is this? Okay, I'm gonna have to go into my other thing, y'all. It's trying to tell me something about this. Hold on. Give me 1 second, please. All right, got it. Okay. So yes, that was the end of that chapter, child. Let me get ready for this next chapter here. Yeah, here she is running like a Lonnie. But it wouldn't be an Ashley book, honey, if she wasn't running. So, yeah. Chapter 17. Morgan's tears fell down her face as she stumbled into the hotel suite. She needed to lay eyes on Bash. She needed to try to trick her heart, convince it that he was the one, that he could produce the same feeling, that he was capable of making it skip beats, of making her soak. Morgan didn't even think about what she would say about being soaking wet and in a bikini. She rushed through the large room seeking him, needing him to make her feel. She opened the door to the bedroom and stopped when she saw that he was asleep. Her feet were at the threshold of the room. All she had to do was step across it and climb in the bed with her fiancé. She could do this. She could find her place in his world. She had done a good job of faking these past 2 years. She had gotten quite skilled at pretending to be happy, but Christiana chose everything in her life, from what she majored in to what she wore. Morgan had lost her identity, and as she stood there, she realized she might not have ever known who she was to begin with. She had been reacting to life for a long time instead of creating the life she wanted. The last time she remembered living, truly living, and knowing who she was, the night at the club 2 years ago, the day I found out I was pregnant. Things had fallen apart after that day. Everything that she had thought was real had been exposed as fake. And confusion settled into her life. It had taken permanent residence in her soul. With Meek, she didn't feel unsure. Afraid? Yes. Ashamed? Maybe. Uncertain? No. She knew exactly who she could be with him, and he saw her for who she was, not who she was pretending to be. He saw through her, and the cracked mirror that no one else could see still held value to him. Morgan turned and walked out of the suite. Her heart was racing, and she was crying because she knew it was a possibility that she was about to ruin her life. She was about to risk it all on a man that she had never even considered until now, a man that she should have never considered. Even now, nerves filled her as she headed to the elevator. She got inside and pressed the button for the 25th floor. She had 15 stories to change her mind. She wished that she would. She prayed for someone or something to stop this from happening, because once she did this one thing, there was no taking it back. She knew all the reasons why she shouldn't, but when the doors opened, she stepped off anyway. Room 2514. She spun in circles, trying to figure out which way to go, and then hurried feet carried her to Meek's door. She lifted her hand to knock, and before the anxiety eating away at her stomach stopped her, she connected her knuckles with the wood. Meek pulled open the door, dressed in a Versace robe and nothing else, holding his phone in his hand. He stopped speaking mid-sentence. Caught up in her rapture, he froze, stunned. Yo, bro, I'm gonna get with you in the AM. He hung up the phone without waiting for a response. I needed Meek, she whispered. Yes, yes, God. All right, here we go, y'all. Marva, freezer time. I'm trying to give you a second to get there, girl. All right. Lust and desperation clung to every word. She stepped closer to him, shivering, because now the towel covering the wet swimsuit was soaked. The air conditioning was on blast, or at least that's what she told herself. The chills were from the cold, not from Meek, but she knew better. He made her quiver. He hadn't even touched her yet, and her toes were already curling. Namo. His rejection shocked her. She wore her surprise on her pretty face and recoiled, jerking her neck back. I'm that easy to dismiss, she scoffed. That easy to move on from? Fuck Mo, get her like, forget her like that, she said, snapping her fingers. She saw Messiah in her mind, cursing her out and deserting her on Blue's lawn all over again, feelings on the floor, self-esteem beneath his heels, self-worth dug into the dirt. Meek's rejection was the moral thing to do, but damn, woman just wanted to be bad. She shook her head as droplets of emotion threatened to spill from her eyes. She turned, and Meek grabbed her fingertips, pulling her into the room. He closed and locked the door and then trapped her against it. I'm not curving you, Morgan. You're just not ready, he said. He looked down at her. She looked up at him. Then his hands cupped her face, swiping away at her tears. Let's press pause. Wait. If it's supposed to happen, it'll happen. If it ain't, it won't. He said it like he wasn't stressing over pussy, like he had it on speed dial, like he could order the shit up. Pussy, extra wet with a side of head. She knew he could. She knew he had options, and suddenly the idea of that burned her. I need it, Meek, she repeated. I can't wait. She placed both hands on his chest, then slid one south until she found his gangster. He was solid in her palm, wide and long. The motherfucking trifecta. Her breath caught in her throat, and he stood there staring, waiting, letting her probe his manhood with one hand, then two. She could feel him pulsing. His desire for her was palpable, but still there was hesitation in those eyes. They were as dark as midnight and held some remorse. Oh, he whispered, stop, love. We both know this is wrong. But what if it's not, she asked. Meek blew out air. He was frustrated. She could see his conflict. She could feel hers. The shit I want to do to you, he admitted. There was pain behind that statement. Shame. Morgan didn't care. Show me, she gasped, her hands moving up and down his length as he grew in her grasp. He gripped her shoulders, leaning forward, placing his forehead against hers, eyes closed, restraint wavering. She brought her hands back to an appropriate place, to his face. Never knew Murder Meek to hesitate. She could barely whisper the words. Her emotions were all over the place, choking her. A storm destroyed her insides, uprooting every single principle she thought she stood for. What was right and wrong, anyway? Shoot first, ask questions later, remember? Mo, I ain't the nigga to hit something and give the shit back. You hear me? He asked. If it's what I think it is, I'ma be possessive over that shit, and I'ma want it when I want it. That nigga can't touch you if I'm touching you, because I'ma kill him. I get real ignorant over mine. Meek, she whispered, almost whining. It took everything in me to come to your room. All that I had, every piece of courage I could find. Can we work out the details later? He reached around her and helped himself to a helping of her ass, a handful, then two. Then her feet left the ground as he scooped her. She climbed him, wrapping her arms around his neck as he kissed her. Morgan's heart bled out. It oozed emotion, her angst spilling across the floor, leaving invisible remnants of her need in a trail at his feet. She was filled with unbelievable need as he carried her across the room. He placed her on her feet, then turned her around. She turned to him, but he spun her around, placing a delicate kiss to the back of her neck before bending her over the bed. Ooh, the ankles, love, he said, planting teeth in one ass cheek. Morgan's arch was like the heel on a 6-inch red bottom. That weight gain looked like a platter to a nigga like me. He placed his hands on her behind and gripped her flesh, rotating before planting a light smack. The blow didn't injure. It was instigating, like he wanted to see how all that ass would react to his touch. Oh, he groaned in appreciation as it moved for him. He took a knee, like Morgan deserved a little respect, like an injustice had been committed, like this was NFL Sunday and he was suited up on the field. Then he peeled that bikini bottom off her body. Morgan's knees planted into the bed and she reached for her ankles, head cocked to the side, pretty yellow ass tooted high as her chest pressed into the bed. Boy, stop. Oh, my fucking God. She was open on full display, and he arrested her clit from behind. A face full of real nigga explored her depths, finessing her swollen sex with expertise. She wouldn't last long in this position. She couldn't last long at all. In fact, she was already creaming. Morgan was in trouble. She knew it. Head like this would drive her crazy. Meek was submerged in her, hands on the sides of her ass, opening her wider so he could go deeper. Meek, she whimpered. Yella, he whispered, a peck to her most sensitive place, then three fingers, not two, never two, because two wouldn't prep her for what he was about to deliver. This is bad. This is so bad, she whined. Our love, this is good. All good, Miss Atkins, he whispered. He sucked on her again. He groaned. So fucking good, Mo. He stared at her seed and licked backward all the way until he reached the end and then ate her there too. Morgan came back on her thighs and stretched her arms forward. Feed a nigga, Mo, he groaned. I'm dying, she moaned. My God, Meek, stop. It feels so. Before she could finish her sentence, he was inside her. Meek, no condom. She didn't even care because she didn't want a barrier between them. For 2 years, an entire ocean had been between them. Now he was swimming in one, in her waters. No life jacket. Morgan hadn't been touched in so long. 2 years of emptiness to being filled in an instant had her climbing the walls. Meek pulled her wrist, reining her in so she wouldn't run as he tagged up from the back. It was a mixture between love making and fucking. Not rough, not gentle, but appreciative. Like he had sexed her before in his dreams and it was finally coming true. Oh, fuck, he groaned. Two hands to her hips for guidance, and then he pulled. Slap, 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 slap. Skin to skin, he beat it. And the music their bodies made echoed off the walls, accompanied by the soundtrack of Mo's falsetto as she screamed his name. He had knocked down two orgasms like they were bowling pins. He was trying to pick up the spares. He pulled the rest out of her. All in one round. She gripped the sheets, clasping them, her fingers curling in delirium from the stroke he was gifting her with. A tender ache filled her every time he went deep, never too deep, never with the intention to assault, but to bring pleasure. He was walking a tightrope between pleasure and pain, using all his ability to keep the balance that kept her soaked for him, that made her open wider for him. Morgan wasn't running. She was taking all of him, every single inch, as he tugged on her, thugged on her, beasting on her. The kiss to the middle of her back left tingles in the place of acknowledgement. She wondered why he'd chosen that spot. What was he appreciating about the crease down the center of her back? His next stroke snatched the thought from her mind, and Morgan threw her body back onto him. Damn, love, he gritted his teeth, and then she felt him lose restraint as he entered her with aggression, splitting her in half with one volatile stroke before pulling out and releasing onto the bed. Morgan rolled onto her back, moving wet hair out of her face and staring at the ceiling in disbelief. It was fucking phenomenal. Her womanhood throbbed. It had taken a licking, and she could feel it ticking in response from all it had endured. He came up her body and hovered over her. You okay? So thoughtful, kind. No voids in his ability to show emotion, but far from soft. Only behaving this way because it was her. His dream girl. She nodded. You sure? The consideration, the double checking to make sure that she spoke truth and nothing less. It melted her heart. She nodded again as a tear ran out of the crease of her eye. He used his thumb to clear it. What now? She asked. The fog, or rather frog, in her throat capturing her voice. It was barely audible. She was afraid. He could see it. He could feel it. Her hesitation. We take it one step at a time, love, he said. He lowered, kissing her lips. His skin stuck to hers and then peeled away slowly as he pulled back, made Morgan's eyes close. She relished there because the feeling was glorious. It wasn't the act of being coveted. It was being coveted by someone who didn't like to, who didn't know how to, who only did it because his heart wouldn't allow him to do anything else. Meek didn't love women. He fucked many, but loved none. Until now. Now he loved one, and it wasn't new. Morgan didn't know how she had ever missed it before. She had been in love with another, and Meek had watched from afar. Now that he had her beneath him, connected through her essence to his life source, she felt every single inch of his affection. My God, every inch. Morgan gasped as he reached down, gripping his strength before guiding it back into her depths. But take it real slow, he whispered. A night of passion, full of pleasure, and Morgan endured it all as Meek helped himself to her body over every inch of his suite. Even when she thought he was done, when they thought the moment had passed, he hit rewind and pressed play all over again. Morgan was exhausted. After hours of this marathon, her inner thighs were so weak she could barely walk. She lay under him, the white sheet covering their bodies as he reached for the room service they had ordered. Give me some, she said, opening her mouth as she leaned into his plate. He placed his fork in her mouth. My plate is your plate, too. That's the type of girl you are, huh? He chuckled as she nodded, closing her eyes to savor the buttermilk pancakes. That's the exact type of girl I am, she answered, smiling. She stood from the bed, and her bare body arrested his attention. Morgan was thick, a man's dream. Two babies had done her well. She had more ass than she preferred, and her hips had spread something vicious. Meek's favorite part was the one roll right where her bra rested. It only appeared at certain angles, and it had driven him crazy all night as he hit her from the back. Gorgeous as fuck. He reached for her and pulled her back to the bed. She giggled. Such a carefree sound, like she'd loved him all her life. She didn't know if this was love or infatuation, but it brought out her inner being. It brought out the girl who loved to dance, the girl who kicked ass at spades and collected the books while talking cash shit, the girl who wanted to open a dance studio for deaf kids, not pursue medicine. He turned her into the girl she was brave enough to be 2 years ago. You can have the food, he said. Let me just get this one more time. He pulled her to his face and sat her down right on top of it. I can't, she moaned. The twins wake up at 7 religiously. He glanced over at the clock. It was already 6:04 in the morning. This is fast food, love. Meek, no, she laughed, trying to resist. He reached for his phone as Morgan sat on his chest. I tell you what, he said, thumbing through his screen. Give me one song, she smirked. One song, Meek. He pressed play. Ain't never been a man wanting anything much as I want you. Sun doesn't come up till morning, so tonight there's no excuse. Marcus Houston filled the room, an old song but new to Mo because she hadn't been able to hear it when it had come out. It was the longest song on his playlist, 4 minutes, 27 seconds. Mealtime, he smirked, lifting her right onto his lips. Morgan's head fell forward as his tongue made a quick meal of her womanhood. She rolled her body slowly, riding both his face and the beat. She lifted a dainty finger, snapping. She closed her eyes as she got lost in the lyrics. Come on, baby, turn the lights off. Let's get naked. The music vibrated through her body, lifting her, making her heart flutter, and she forgot that this was sex. It felt like art, like she was expressing sensuality, dancing to the slow beat and riding his tongue so viciously that he groaned. He held her backside and attacked her clit. Fuck, she screamed. She lifted her hands and kept grinding slowly like they were two-stepping instead of fucking, and those fingers snapped. Her forehead wrinkled as she trailed one hand down the opposite arm, then down her neck, then across her breast, tweaking her nipples in satisfaction. Morgan lifted on her tiptoes and worked her middle, making him lift his head to reach her pussy. She bounced, eyes still closed. She was in a groove, a beautiful groove, as Meek captured her swollen clit and pulled it into his mouth between those sexy lips, then sucked with just the right pressure. A finger finessed her other hole and Morgan exploded. He was nasty, the nastiest, and Morgan loved it. I'm coming, she whispered. She had lost count. The night had been so long she didn't know anymore. He had her in a sexual fog. After a drought of 2 years and some change, this was too much. One body wasn't supposed to experience this much pleasure. How did he even know how to give this much pleasure? How the fuck did this much pleasure even exist? Morgan had only been with one man before, and he had been the best, but something about the way Meek touched her, the way he used it, the way he didn't care to let his enjoyment leave his lips in moans, calling her name, praising her sex, worshiping her wet. He was a fucking beast, and she understood why he had his pick of every woman in every room he'd ever entered. The song faded, and Morgan gripped the top of the headboard, breathing so heavy that her breasts rose, then fell. She lifted from him, and he pulled her to his face, kissing her forehead. Thank you, Miss Atkins, for blessing a nigga, he said. Made a young nigga from Flint's dreams come true like a motherfucker. She blushed and pulled back before rushing into the bathroom. Not even the steaming hot shower could wash away her sins. She had been kissed everywhere, and his lips had left a stain. Messiah's best friend had taken her places that he shouldn't even know the way to. She had handed him the road map to her body, and he had explored every route. She didn't know how to feel. A mixture of shame and contentment swirled inside her because she knew what it looked like. She knew what people would say when she emerged. He stood there, phone in hand. Yo, I don't give a fuck about none of that shit, nigga. The schedule don't change. Who set the schedule? I set it. Well, you said it. I work for you now, he barked. He was back to gangster, back to business. Morgan pulled her hair into a quick ponytail as she scrambled around the room. Oh, shit, my clothes, she whispered. She had left the plastic bag in her hotel suite the night before. Meek snapped his fingers at her, trying not to break up his phone conversation and get her attention all at once. He pointed to the bags that sat by the front door of the suite. Morgan frowned, walking over to them and opening them. An Adidas women's jogging suit and new Yeezy sneakers in her exact size lay inside. She opened the La Perla bag to find undergarments down to the socks. She lifted stunned eyes to him. He had measured her by eye. He was so well-versed with pussy that he could guess her sizes without asking. She didn't know if she should be flattered by the thought or offended that he hadn't gotten anything wrong. How many women has he been with, she thought. The way he worked her body over, she suspected more than a few. He was a connoisseur. She slipped into the clothes, and he walked over to her, slightly distracted by the transaction taking place in his ear. Hold on, he said. He lowered the phone to his side and wrapped one hand around her waist, jerking her toward him. He helped himself to her lips, and just like that, Morgan's worries eased. She didn't care who he was besides her, or who he was with besides her. She had a situation, too. Who was she to judge? I'll call you when we get back, he said, if that's okay. She stalled as she looked at him. Are we sure about this? People will talk. They'll think what they want to think. As long as you know what it is, I'm good, he stated. Morgan felt a pull in her chest. Did she know? What did this mean? I don't like being judged, Meek. I don't like being whispered about or stared at, Morgan said. He could hear the insecurities in her. They do that anyway. Every time you enter a room, they talk and they stare. You have no clue what you do, love, Meek said. No fucking clue. I'm afraid of this with you, she admitted. Bullshit, love? Me too, he answered. She smiled at that. I can press pause. I can act like none of this ever happened if you want me to, Mo. Ball's in your court. How will it happen again if I pretend it never happened the first time, she asked. She headed for the door, and as she pulled it open, his baritone made her take pause. Yo! She turned to him with curious eyes. London is a wrap. I need you around for a while, he said. No inflection in his tone because it wasn't a question. He wasn't requesting her presence. She knew an order when she heard one, and as much as she wanted to buck, she didn't because she liked that shit. She smirked and her heart raced because he was a motherfucking man. All dominance, no waver. She didn't answer because she was a woman with covert manipulation that turned his dominance into her own. She walked out of the room feeling her power as a woman, as Morgan Atkins, as Benny Atkins' seed, as Ethic Okafor's daughter. For the first time in a long time, Morgan felt like she was in control of her life. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. I don't know what y'all be. Y'all ain't said shit, heifers. Y'all just been here listening. Oh, my God. Y'all just been sitting here. Hello. Y'all supposed to be typing and talking. Y'all ain't said shit. Good googly moogly. Finally, that chapter ended. That was a long-ass chapter, bro. Good God almighty. That chapter made my back hurt. Oh, jeebus. Hold on, y'all. I don't even know what to say. Good googly moogly. All right, hold on. Let me see. I know some of y'all about need to go to the bathroom. Look at this one. Honey. I know that's right. I ain't mad at all. You heard me? Mm-mm-mm. Not at all. No, ma'am. No, ma'am. Wait a minute, y'all. I need 1 second. Child, the messages just don't quit. Let me see him. Let's see. Sorry, y'all. Child, my heart almost left my body. Oh, Jesus, creepers. Here we go. Oh, my goodness. Here we go. I just did something weird here. All right. Okay. Got it. All right, so let me get my time stamp together for this next chapter, y'all. Y'all are hanging with me. Child, listen. It said we only got about 1 hour and 9 minutes left in this book, so this ain't so bad. I was hoping to be done sooner, but child, listen. After this chapter, it's only 3 more, so that's not so bad. Y'all can hang with a bitch till the end. Y'all done been over here longer than that, so I don't think y'all in that big of a damn hurry. Mm-mm. All right. I know y'all still at work, but y'all, I gotta wet my whistle. And in the meantime, child, life is life. And so listen. Ah, child, I love y'all. So listen, that's why I do it. Mm-mm. Got to keep my sippers and speakers happy. Listen, this thing is need to go on a charge or something. Because it's acting real fucking stupid. Like it's a slow bopper for Christ or something. And I'm about to throw this fucking thing. Well, I don't know.
About that.
Are you not supposed to shake it?
No. I'm not supposed to shake that.
I thought it said you could shake it. Well, shaking it made it better. It stopped acting stupid. Every once in a while, you got to slap a bitch or shake her or something. Because I don't know. Didn't it work? Yeah, right. Unacid. Hell, trying to tell me I'm a woman. I know everything. Oh, now I feel all special and stuff. Don't worry about it. I got it. Thank you, Kim Cash. Y'all love me. That's good to know, honey. And I done skirted past my damn thing here. Here we go. Oh, shit. Now, here we go. Ain't nobody ask you. You said what?
Sometimes it works.
I know, because shaking it is the shit. My shakes are the shit. All right, there you go. That sounded real weird, but oh my God. Excuse me. Lord have mercy. Chapter 18. Morgan crept back into Arya's suite and rushed to the second bedroom where her babies were still sleeping. She pulled Masari up and cradled him in her arms. "Wake up, my handsome boy," she whispered. She kissed the top of his head and the sound of his whines melted her. "Mommy, sorry," she sang as she rocked him in her arms. She loved both her babies, but Masari reminded her of his father so much. Now, when's she gonna tell, what you call it, that these is Messiah's kids? Child, listen, I'm like, what the hell? Because I don't even understand. I'd be looking crazy when I be in my office just smiling. Little do they know, Saki talking shit about these books having me cracking. Oh my God, listen, the way y'all be DMing me, telling me that y'all be at work cracking up laughing, and y'all co-workers be looking at y'all like y'all crazy than a motherfucker. Sorry. The very best parts. She closed her eyes. She placed him on the bed and then reached for their luggage. She removed clothes and pull-ups and quickly dressed Masari. "Did you have fun with Auntie Arya?" she asked. He nodded. "Of course he did." Morgan turned to the door to find Arya at the door. "Isn't that right, boyfriend?" Arya asked. Masari struggled to jump from the high bed, not caring that he wasn't big enough to do it on his own. He was fearless, and Morgan shook her head as he hit the floor hard and then quickly recovered to run full speed to Arya. "Are you hungry?" she asked. Masari made kissy noises as he gave Arya a big kiss and wrapped his arms around her neck. "Aw, you make me feel so special, sorry," Arya sang. Morgan smiled and then reached for Yara. So, you want to tell me where you snuck off to last night? I know you weren't with Bash because he called here looking for you. What did you tell him? Morgan asked, her heart sinking. The thought of having to explain where she was terrified her for some reason. Morgan wasn't instinctively dishonest. And having to conceal last night's escapades gave her anxiety. I told him you were asleep. I'm down for the alibi, but where the hell were you? I just sat in the casino all night. I just needed to think, Morgan lied. The sound of the suite's doorbell rang out. Morgan sighed in relief as Aria turned. I'm ordering food. You want anything? What the kids like? Anything you order is fine, Mo said. I'll be out after I dress Yara. Aria nodded and pulled the door closed, taking Masari with her. Yara whined and hugged Morgan's neck tightly. She was fussy in the morning. It never failed. Morgan rubbed her hair and rocked her. She pulled back and signed to her daughter, Mommy loves her lollipop. Yara pouted and rested her sleepy head on Morgan's chest. She wasn't in the mood to reply. A true meanie in the morning. Yara wasn't ready to interact with anyone but the Sandman. Morgan sat her down and changed her into fresh clothes, a Burberry check dress and cardigan because it was cool inside the hotel. She brushed her hair up into a pretty puff and placed a headband around her head. She carried her on her hip and walked out of the room. She stopped mid-step when she saw Amik sitting at the long rectangular table. Her heart lurched inside her chest as she forgot to breathe. Yara lit up when she saw him and scrambled to get down. Morgan placed her on her feet and she ran to the table to Amik's side. What up, smart girl? Amik asked as he reached down to lift her onto the table in front of him. Morgan was stuck. She just stood there looking stupid as Aria, Amik, and her kids ate breakfast. Aria's brow pinched as she looked from Mo to Amik and back to Mo. She said. Casino all night, huh? Aria snickered. Morgan blew out a flustered breath and made her way to the table. She felt exposed, like everyone in the room could see through her. Hey, Amik, what are you doing here? She asked. Good morning, Mo, he greeted, playing it much cooler than she was capable of doing. He fisted his beard and smiled, then focused his attention on Yara. How's my favorite girl? His favorite girl, Aria repeated, and stared a hole through Morgan. Morgan refused to look at Aria. She felt the accusing stare, but she simply reached for a plate and began to help herself to the spread. Yara was giving her away. No way should she be this familiar with Meek. Stop feeding that nigga Cheerios, lollipop. No. She thought. She made a mental note to never commit a murder with Yara. She would for sure get them caught. So, what you do last night, murder Meek? Aria asked. I was cooling, Meek answered, his eyes never leaving Yara as she pulled on his beard. Aria pinched off a piece of pancake and placed it in Masari's mouth. She rolled suspicious eyes back to Morgan. You might want to put some makeup on that hickey before you go back to Bash, she stated bluntly. Morgan's hand shot to her neck. The side of Meek had devoured just hours ago. Something must have bitten me. Something. Okay. She said as she rushed to the mirror on the wall. Sure enough, there was a hickey on her neck. Probably, Aria said, giving Morgan a knowing look. Issa emerged from the master bedroom. Yo, bro, you ready to ma? Meek asked, standing with Yara in his arms. Yeah, we up, Issa said. Rebook that flight, Ali. I want you in my bed when I get back. Aria glanced at Mo. You want to stay a few more days? Aria asked. I can't, Mo declined. She didn't ask if you could. She asked if you wanted to, Meek said, eyes on his phone screen as he struggled to text with one hand while holding Yara with the other. Morgan's insides twisted as she wondered who was on the other end of that message. Mo, Aria pushed. I can't. Meek's brow knitted, and he walked over to her, standing directly in front of her. Morgan reached for Yara, but Yara pulled against her, wanting to stay in Meek's arms. Morgan felt that. She hadn't wanted to let him go either. Come on, lollipop, she signed. He has to go. She forced Yara to let go and put her down. Yara instantly clung to her leg. Hey, the word came with a finger beneath her chin as he lifted her face to his, forcing her to meet his eyes. If you want to stay, stay. The twins ain't a problem. I've got business out here, but afterward. I know you fucking lying, Aria whispered in disbelief. Mind yours, Issa stated, not bothering to look up from his phone. Why, when hers is so much juicier, Aria stated. Amik, right, You can't, Ameek stated, nodding. Morgan had never felt so nervous. Meek was standing too close, looking too hard. He was worse than Yollipop. The nigger was a snitch. He was letting it be known that he was invested, and he didn't seem fazed that Issa or Ari was witnessing this public display. He pinched her chin and then rubbed his thumb over her lips. Morgan couldn't breathe, let alone speak. He pulled his bottom lip into his mouth like he was restraining himself. A part of Morgan wished he wouldn't. Travel safe, Mo. Morgan held her breath until Issa and Meek walked out the door. Bitch, you fucking Meek? Aria shouted. Aria, my babies. Girl, fuck these kids. Your ass is fucking Meek. Aria stood from the table as Morgan scooped Yara and retreated to the bedroom where her babies had slept. Oh my God, when did this happen? How did it happen? Bitch, was it good? I bet he's good. Aria, Morgan shouted. What if I asked you if you were fucking Issa? You saw us last night. You want details? The nigga dick is big as fuck. And you eat that shit from the back. There you go. You got all my tea. Now fucking spill, Aria shouted. He's amazing, Morgan moaned as she collapsed onto her bed. She sat Yara down beside her and then buried her head in her hands. How did I let this happen? Fuck all the guilt trips, Mo. I need the play-by-play, Aria said, clapping with every word. She sat in the chair across the room. I'm engaged, Morgan said. And you shouldn't be, Aria said. Ameek makes me feel... Morgan paused. Aria pushed. The last time I felt like this was with Messiah. He makes me feel like I'm all he sees. I know that I can't have him. Can't love him. Love him, Mo? How long has this been going on? Aria asked. Since London. He's the reason I came home. I knew I couldn't stay there. As soon as he left London, I wanted to leave too. I just wanted the possibility to run into him. My heart aches around him, and it was friendly at first. We talked, we chilled, but the time together feels natural. It feels good. And then last night, Morgan closed her eyes. It felt like love, Aria. Every touch, the places he kissed, the things he said. My heart just craves him. Even right now, I just want to be around him. I want to be under him, watching Netflix. I want to go grocery shopping with him because he occupies the twins so well. I just want him, and he's Messiah's friend. It's wrong. First of all, you don't owe Messiah anything. Yeah, it's a little fucked up, but he's dead, Mo. And before he was dead, he tore you apart. You tried to kill yourself behind that boy, Mo. He sucked the life out of you. If you think this thing with you and Meek is real, you deserve to see where it leads. You deserve to be happy, and that's not with Bash. I can't leave Bash, Mo whispered. Well, if you think Meek is going to be by your side, nigga, or be your side, nigga, and keep it on the low, you're highly mistaken. Men like Meek don't stay in the shadows. You see what he just pulled in here? He's fucking you. And from the looks of it, he is in his feelings. He sniffed it one time and now he wants more. He's got Yara feeding him Cheerios and he's caressing your lips and shit like you got a ring on your finger. Ooh. He won't care who's watching. If he fucks with you, he's gonna fuck with you all the time. You won't be able to keep it a secret. Be careful, Mo. You're gonna have to make a choice. Let Bash go or leave Meek alone. They're both really good guys and you deserve a good guy. You don't have to feel guilty about it either because it ain't shit a ghost can do but haunt you. You shouldn't feel bad about finding happiness with Meek. Messiah left you with a lot of pain. I say you're entitled to heal what he broke any way you see fit, as long as it's healthy. And there's a break in the chapter. Oh, child, listen. Why is she playing hopscotch and double dutch with these two niggas? You don't want Bash? His old uptight, boring ass life. Child, you'll have gray hair by the time you 30. Fuck out of here. No. And you'll be constipated with a stick up your ass. You gonna turn into his mama. Is that who the fuck you wanna be? And you gonna turn your kids into you? Mm-mm. No, God. That's some good shit. All right. So, you want to tell me about Lil Morgan, G? Issa asked as they stepped out of the elevator and headed toward the exit. What's to tell? Meek asked, eyes on his phone screen as they stepped out into the scorching sun. Issa pulled a valet ticket from his pocket and handed it to the attendant. So, you finally doing what Messiah asked you to do? Issa asked. It ain't about Messiah. Wait, pause. Asked you to do. I'm telling y'all, I don't recall him asking her. Him. You know what the fuck I mean. Do y'all recall that shit? Because I the fuck don't. I really don't, y'all. I promise. I remember him saying, look after her, take care of her, but not fuck her. Oh, you know what? Maybe it's what he said, like that he remembered the way that she danced on him and the way Meek had looked. Was that what he said? Ooh, chile. Maybe he did, y'all. I don't know what it's about, but it ain't for play, and I ain't looking for permission. Be careful with her, bro. We all know how it ended last time. Mo's family, we all fucked up when it came to her. She don't deserve that twice. She didn't deserve it the first time. I don't intend on fucking up, Meek stated. The S-Class Mercedes they had rented pulled up, and Meek climbed into the passenger seat. Issa hopped behind the wheel. Now you ready to talk about this money, or you still worried about where I'm sticking my dick, bitch-ass nigga? Yo, on some real shit, though, bruh. I got one more question, then we can move on. Messiah was secretive as fuck about the shit, but I gotta know. Lil Morgan, what that shit hidden for? I know Shorty's sitting on that Edison, healer nigga type of pussy. Nigga, Amik said, shooting a warning glare at Issa. You got it bad, G, Issa said, snickering as he put the car in drive. Meek's jaw tensed as they took the highway away from the tourist trap. It was hard to keep his mind on business. Morgan had put something on him last night that had left a stain. He would never confirm for Issa, but the type of pussy she was serving was the type to heal a nigga. It was the type with the potential to hurt a nigga, too. From the moment she had walked out of his suite, he had been in his feelings. It had taken everything in him not to go to her room and pack up her and her twins and buck on her fiancé. The thought of her going from his bed to Bash's made him feel raw on the inside. Morgan had a pull on him, something serious, and he knew she was a problem, a big fucking problem. The city gave way to golden sand and a two-way highway, and Issa hit 90 miles per hour. Who you say these motherfuckers were again? Meek asked. Some tribal investors want to open a casino about an hour and a half north of Flint. They'll have armored trucks running up and down the highway. I'm talking big money, nigga. This is different than the semis. One armored truck is enough to live for life. They want to guarantee that their loads make it to their destination safe. It's a tax for that. They gotta pay the toll, Issa said. Otherwise, I'm lifting that bitch. Armored trucks are a different game, G, Meek answered. Die packs on the cash, armed drivers, an armed man in the bed of the truck, GPS under the hood, marked bills. The shit's risky. You scared, nigga? Issa asked. I'm smart, motherfucker, Meek answered. I know you be on your adrenaline shit, bro, but this shit ain't the move. Popping the back of the fucking truck alone would be a task. That shit is military grade steel. Well, let's hope it doesn't come to that. They pay the toll to pass those trucks through the city, and we can get the easy bag, Issa stated. They saw a bar in the middle of nowhere, a little wooden shack on the side of the road. Three cars sat parked out front. This the spot? Meek asked. Meek reached under the seat and retrieved a 9mm pistol. The price of the private jet was worth the ability to stay strapped. He didn't go anywhere unprotected. If you saw Meek, he was strapped at the doctor's office, in church, at funerals. Any door he graced, he carried a gun through it. Yeah, I think so. Shit is 2 hours outside of Vegas. It better be it, Issa added. They stepped out the car, tucked their pistols, then swaggered to the front door. Meek pulled it open and walked inside. A man with skin so rich it appeared red stood behind the bar. Long, raven-hued hair hung down his shoulders, center-parted. Wrinkles filled his face as if they told a story, like the aged leather on a good bag. His every mark was representative of a journey he had taken. Long way from where you're welcome, the man gruffed. He reached beneath the counter and came up with a shotgun. We were invited, Issa said. I want to lower that gun, old man, before I lose my patience. By the time you cock that bitch back, I'll serve that ass the daily special, Meek stated in a cool baritone. Not an ounce of fear lived in either of them because they knew if it came down to them walking out of the building or the men in this bar, they were going to step. The Native American man looked at the other patrons at the bar and lifted his hand off the shotgun. We're here for Hakani, Issa stated. The man pulled out a cell phone and kept skeptical eyes on the duo before placing the phone to his ear. Ha, expecting someone? The man gruffed. Amik's hands rested in front of him, one fist over the opposite wrist on the ready. Stay cool, bruh, Issa said under his breath. This is just an introduction. Two of them, the man reported to the other end of the phone. I'm sure they're holding. Another pause. Mm-hmm. I'll send them back. Jasper, take them to the reservation. Hawk says let them keep their weapons. Apparently, this is a friendly visit, the man gruffed. A stout man stood from the bar. His long hair was now white, his skin bronzed and aged by the sun. When he turned to them, a long scar permanently sealed one eye. "He'll take you to hop," the bartender said. A Meek gave Issa a skeptical look, and as Issa followed the man out of the bar, Meek backpedaled, keeping eyes on the men remaining inside. He walked over to an open-air Jeep, and a Meek took the back seat as Issa hopped into the passenger side. The man drove behind the bar, taking them off-road through the sand, leaving a cloud of dust behind them as they ventured 2 miles deep into the desert. They stopped in front of a large brick building, a compound of sorts, and Meek climbed out. Armed men stood like soldiers outside. Warrior paint covered their faces. What the fuck? Meek thought as he followed the man inside. They passed 20 people working on laptops as they made their way to the back and entered an office door. A man in tailored designer slacks, Ferragamo shoes, and an Oxford shirt stood speaking on the phone. One hand was in his pants pocket and he removed it to hold up a finger for them. "I'll need the permits immediately. We have a schedule to keep. Sounds like a plan. Speak soon." He ended the phone call, and a smile accompanied the hand he extended to them. "I'm Hawk. You must be Issa and Amik," he stated. Amik shook the man's hand, followed by Issa. "Please, sit." They all took a seat on the relaxed side of the luxurious office. This space didn't seem like it belonged in the middle of the desert, or like in a high-rise building in New York City. It was like a mirage. It almost didn't exist. "I'm a man who does my homework. I own Hakani Enterprises, and I'm building a casino on tribal land in Saginaw. That's in your backyard. I hear there are pretty strict laws of the land that I need to respect if my business is going to be successful. The 30-mile stretch of highway between Flint and Saginaw is yours. I'd like free access to it. I need to insure my investments. I'd like my trucks to be able to pass through without interference. I'd even like for them to be escorted by your team to make sure they aren't disturbed by others as well. I'm willing to pay for this insurance." "How many trucks a week?" Meek asked. 14. One at the start of business, one at the end of business each week." "That's a lot of insurance," Issa stated. "I understand. How does $100,000 a month sound?" "Sounds like you think we're still working corners. That's less than $2,000 a truck." "We can't even pay our people with that," Meek said. "We can just take the fucking trucks. The art of business is in the negotiation, Amik. You tell me a more appropriate number," Hawk said. "I'll know it when I hear it," Meek stated. Issa knew to let Amik work. They had very distinct roles, and Meek's was in the gift of gab. He already had a number in his head, but he would never undercut the team by speaking first. He needed to see how high Hawk was willing to go first. "You're a smart man," Hawk complimented, wagging a finger at Amik. "What's your number?" Issa added. 50,000 a truck," Hawk said. "Each," Amik interjected. "Small price to pay to make sure those trucks go untouched." Hawk sat back in his chair and steepled his hands under his chin. He took his time before nodding. He reached into his desk drawer and removed two iPads. He slid them across the desk. "Swiss accounts have been set up on these devices for you. The money for the first month's runs will be deposited within the hour. You can log into your accounts and check them anytime. Nice doing business with you, gentlemen. It's time to get rich." Lord have mercy. That's a lot of money, y'all. That's a lot of money. 50,000 a truck, right? Each. So that's 100,000 a truck times 14 trucks a week. Ooh, child. Let me go move Lil Morgan out the way and holler at Amik, child. Listen, if she got medicine, I have the fountain of youth, motherfucker. She can heal you, but I can keep you young, daddy. I can keep you alive. You will never get sick. Bye, Morgan. Oh, my God. Listen. Yes. Okay. You did, Shanae, child. Listen, newsflash, everybody. Let me give this lady her flowers, honey. Shanae was right. She had told me, y'all, that Messiah told Meek to get with Morgan. I thought I recalled him saying, take care of her. I didn't know he said, fold it up in her like a love letter and shit. But perhaps I misunderstood. Maybe I'm slipping, child. I don't know, but I didn't recall that. But thank you, Shanae, and you were right. You did tell me that. You absolutely did, child. And my hard-headed ass was, so am I right? I'm ready to bunny hop, child. Listen. Mm-mm. You a mess, Kim. I swear. You are a whole mess, and I ain't mad at it at all. All right, let me get back to this. Oh my God, I'm choking. Water going up my nose. Y'all forgive me. Oh my God, I was trying to. Oh my God. Listen, Linda, that water coming out my nose. Oh my God. Oh my God. Because I'm sitting over here thinking about. Oh, Kim Cash remind me of how I would have been at her age if I was single and ready to mangle. You heard me? Listen, Linda. And child, my fucking throat was like, show you right. And closed up on a bitch. Water coming out my nose. Oh my God. Forgive a bitch, okay? Y'all like, what the fuck was that? Oh, Lord. I'm sorry. All right, here we go. Smile, Morgan. I swear, the way you sulk sometimes, I think you don't know what family you're marrying into, Christiana said as she sipped the glass of champagne in her left hand while flipping the page of the picture book she was reading to Masari with the other. What the fuck is she doing with Bash's mammy? Masari rested comfortably in her arms. She was his nana, and suddenly Morgan hated that she had created the attachment for her children. Ease up, Ma, Bash said. He reached across the divider that separated their seats and grabbed her hand, but she pulled away, tucking her hands between her crossed legs. Yara sat on his lap, and Morgan's eyes bounced back and forth between her twins. They were so comfortable with the Fredericks. They were family. From the day they were born, they had been accepted by the prestigious family. Morgan knew she should be grateful, and she was, but it wasn't like they had pulled her out of the gutter. They acted like she came from a third world country, like she was missing meals and lacking shelter when they met her. She knew they didn't mean to offend her, but she'd held her tongue for so long that it was growing tiresome. Sometimes I think you forget the family I come from, Morgan muttered. Christiana and Bash both lifted eyes of shock to her. Amik had fucked some courage into her, apparently, because Morgan had never enforced an opinion of her own on Bash or Chris. They were used to her going with the flow, but after Meek, after feeling the way he made her heart skip beats, the way he made her body ride beats, the way he made her back arch to catch his beat, Mo just wanted to go against the current, to swim upstream. She wanted to hop off the plane, run across the tarmac, and catch one of the black cars back to him immediately. Morgan, really, we already have so much to repair after your little striptease last night. I flew all the way stateside just to check on you. The last thing I need is attitude, Chris said. What has gotten into you lately? Good dick, Morgan thought. She sighed and stood from her seat. I'm just kind of tired and not in the mood to be scolded, Morgan answered. I'm not scolding, dear, just advising. You're in position to take over the world one day, Morgan. With Bash and these beautiful babies, you could run High Society of London. After medical school, you'll open your practice. And why did Morgan need to listen? Chris already had her entire life plotted out anyway. Morgan tuned Chris out as her thumb slid across her phone screen. She tapped on Meek's name. He hadn't texted her in hours. It wasn't like they communicated all the time anyway, but she expected something, anything after the night before. Morgan craved connection. Even the thought of him made her pulse race. And she felt it most between her thighs. Is it bad that I miss you? That's what she sent to him. Anxiety tightened her belly, and she glanced up at Bash, who was occupied with Yara, before tilting to the side so he couldn't see her messages. She didn't have to wait long. Within seconds, bubbles danced on her screen. Nah, love, that ain't bad at all. Morgan smiled. Then her fingers tapped away. That thing you did last night with your tongue, I'm gonna need you to do that again ASAP. And he texted back, love, no nasty talk. Shit's gonna kill a nigga. Morgan snickered, then stood. She needed to see his face. She yearned to hear his voice. Texting was no longer enough. I'm gonna lie down for a bit. I'm kind of tired. Are the twins okay out here? Of course, Morgan, Chris answered. We should be taking off soon. Get some rest. We can handle them during the flight. Morgan stood and retreated to the private sleeping quarters on the private jet. She still couldn't believe Chris had come swooping in from London just to meet them at the airport. To keep things in order, she had said, but Morgan couldn't lie. She didn't mind the luxury of flying back to Michigan on the private jet. It beat commercial flying every day of the week. A perk of being engaged to Bash. She hit FaceTime before she could even lock the door. She smiled when his face popped up on her screen. He was walking, busy. She could tell from the pinched brow he sported, but still he answered. I'm sorry if I'm interrupting. I know you said you have business to handle. Business is interrupting you, Mo. How can I be of service, love? Morgan smiled. Just like that, huh? Stop everything for little old me? Every time, he answered, while looking around, checking his surroundings and not focusing on the screen. I just wanted to see you, she answered, speaking in hushed tones. So stay, he countered. I'm on the jet right now, Morgan said. I can't. Yeah, I'm already not liking this, Meek stated. Not liking what? She asked, frowning. You telling me no, he answered. So ask me something I can say yes to, she shot back. You miss me, Mo? He asked. Like crazy, she whispered. God, what have you done to me? Nah, Mo, a nigga chest been mad tender since you walked out my room this morning. What the fuck have you done to me, love? She smiled. I just loved on you a little bit, that's all. I know you're not lacking for female attention, but all you get from women is physical. It's all about sex. I gave you a little bit more. Nothing major, she said, smirking. So, you loving on me, Mo? You loving a nigga? He asked. She paused. Did she? Could she? Whatever she was feeling, it was very familiar. It was blissful and hopeful and light. Only questions you can say yes to, remember? He reminded with a wink. Her heart felt giddy, and it raced as her lips pulled tighter and she smiled wider. You want me to love you, me? She shot back. Very much so, Morgan Atkins, but let a nigga earn it first. I ain't afraid to earn it. I can make some plans to do that. She swooned. Meek Harris was such a gangster, but he had the gentleman thing down to a science. Morgan felt the plane begin to move. I gotta go. We're about to take off. Call me when you land. I'll text you, she said. We ain't doing easy, remember? Texting is easy. I need to look in your eyes to see if you're bullshitting me, he said. That only applies to me, Meek, she said. Now, love, in this equation, you're the only one with the potential to break hearts around here. I'm gonna carry you proper, Morgan Atkins. But I got a feeling you're gonna drop a nigga shit on the floor, walk all over it, ding my shit up, he stated. Never, she smiled. I'm gonna love you real good, Meek. I wanna be the one you remember. You can't be that, Meek shot back. She jerked her neck backward. And why the hell not? To remember you means I'll have to lose you. I ain't doing that. I'ma do my part, Mo, and eventually that corny nigga gonna be the one reminiscing. Morgan blushed. I gotta go. Then hang up, because right now you got me on some real sucker shit. I don't like to disconnect from you, Mo. I swear to God, I've been fucked up since you climbed out my bed earlier. Yeah, I know what you mean, she whispered. There were stars in her eyes, flutters in her heart. She just wanted to run to him, to stay behind with him, but she couldn't. I want to go skating, Morgan said. Skating? He asked. Yes, roller skating. I want to go when you get back, and I want to skate. I don't want you to be too cool and watch me from the sidelines either. I want you to hold my hand and skate with me. He chuckled. We'll see, love. Now hang up. Do I have to? She whined. He gifted her a full-blown smile as he stopped walking and focused on the camera, finessing his beard. Yeah, you do. Got me out here caking in broad daylight, he said. Morgan stifled her laughter, smiling so bright that her cheeks hurt. She couldn't ever remember smiling like that. A knock at the door caused her to look away. Mo, we're about to take off. Make sure you're buckled in, Bash called through the door. I will, she called back. She turned back to the phone. I'll FaceTime you when I'm home. Okay, he answered. Morgan went to hang up, but hesitated. Just hanging up didn't feel right. It was like she was supposed to say something, do something more, express more, be more to him, say more to him, act as if she'd never see him again just to get a bit of glee off her chest. I think this might be something. She paused. She was afraid to say it, a bit ashamed to admit it because it was way too soon to be feeling like this. It was way too long to feel it at all. It had to be the dick. Morgan was still reeling from the way he'd handle her. Had to be. It couldn't be emotional. Something good. You think right, he said. Morgan hung up the phone before she told him she loved him. She could feel the words bubbling inside her chest. He made her feel like a 15-year-old girl with a crush, like she wanted to write his name next to hers and plan their wedding during third period. Morgan stood and hurried back to her seat. She sighed and leaned her head back onto the headrest, closing her eyes in appreciation. Two hands over her heart to stop it from beating out of her chest. She shook her head in disbelief. She didn't care that Bash was sitting right next to her. It made her know, never mind, that Chris was across from her, staring with inquisitive eyes. Morgan was covered in the remnants of Amik's love, and she couldn't hide it. She was glowing. She felt it. For too long, she had thought she'd die without ever feeling something so potent again. She had seen Amik 100 times, but she was seeing him through new eyes, and she was smitten. She never wanted to come down from this high. Morgan didn't care how risky it was. She was willing to jeopardize her entire world to keep Amik in her life. Fuck a friend. She wanted him as her own. Now that he'd given her a sample, she wanted the whole thing. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Good dick I have you saying, fuck you, mama. I don't give a fuck what you think. Or maybe that's just me. Ooh, chile. I don't know now. Lord, hamburger and french fries. And hot water cornbread, too. Listen. All right. Ooh, oh, shit. Here we go, y'all. It's only 42 minutes left in the book. And now the bullshit. And this is the reason why she had to put this shit in all these books. She should have just killed this nigga off and had Meek tell Morgan that Messiah told him it was okay to love her, all right? Mm-hmm. And then have her tell him that these is Messiah's babies and not Bash's, because that's going to break Amik's heart. I can feel it. Oh, this is going to be some shit. Oh, God. I don't even admit. You know what? Just go to hell. Let me start reading, child, because this is that bullshit. All right. I ain't even write the fucking time stamp down. Already frustrated, y'all. Right, she sure do need a good cuss out and the fuck you finger. Child, listen. This is insane. I don't even know what to say, but whatever, child, because I just feel like this. We got it. That bitch need to be punched in her fucking throat, and that's all I can say about that. All right, so I got my time stamp down. I'm just really trying hard here to hold on and not cuss a bitch smooth the fuck out. Chapter 19. Messiah rode through the derelict city blocks with his neck on a swivel, one hand wrapped around the leather steering wheel of his BMW while the other wrapped tightly around the .45 caliber chrome pistol in his lap. It was his first time in the city in over 2 years, but he wasn't naive enough to think things had changed. It was still the wild, wild west, and he could never be caught slipping. Where the fuck did he get a BMW from? Remember? He nodded to Jeezy as he took the streets by memory. It was something about being home in the hood that made Messiah come alive. He had run through these blocks like a renegade as a kid. They were his. They used to be his, at least, but he could see at first sight that the empire he had built with Issa and Amik was still standing. The graffiti that marked the abandoned houses he passed on the way signified that niggas still saluted his crew. He was an urban legend in the city, and it was nostalgic to cruise through the hood. He knew what people believed. He was dead. He was supposed to be, at least. For a long time, he hadn't thought he would survive. For 2 years, he couldn't see past the pain to even fathom the notion of living. But he had been convinced to try. He had nothing to lose, so why not? He had walked away from the love of his life, from the kingdom he'd built to die. But He hadn't. And now that he had years in front of him, he couldn't see himself enjoying them without her. Messiah pulled up to the elementary school and hopped out of his car. He didn't have much to his name, but the house he'd left with Blue and the car he'd taken with him were paid in full. He didn't worry about the rest. Messiah was a man of means. He would make the rest back in no time, but none of it was worth anything if he didn't have Morgan. He had to get to her, had to talk to her. To lay eyes on her in person would be a blessing. The school bell rang and Messiah posted up on the hood of his car as he watched the kids filter outside. When he spotted the one he was looking for, he shouted, "Hey, yo, homie!" Time away had matured little Savior. His locks were shoulder length and bleached blonde at the bottom. He had gotten tall and he had two big front teeth that were larger than the others. "Uncle Messiah!" Savior took off, running full speed into him, never slowing and throwing his arms around Messiah. "Ma said you were gone. She said you were in a better place," Savior exclaimed. Messiah pulled back, feeling tender as he pinched his nose. Blue Montgomery, his best friend and Savior's mother, was one of few people he cared for. Savior had a special place in his heart. He could only imagine the confusion he felt. "My nephew, nothing's better than home. I had to go away for a while. I was real sick, homie. Your mom didn't think I would get better, but I'm feeling real good now. I'm doing good. So you can stay this time?" Savior asked, excitement playing in his tone. "Yeah, nephew, I'm staying," Messiah said. He gripped the top of Savior's head and ruffled his locks. "Come on, let's get you home so your mama can kill me." Savior snickered. "You finna kill her when you see that fucking baby she got by you, motherfucker." Sorry. Yeah, okay, so he never gave up his car or his bike. But where the fuck they was at? Because he said he didn't have nothing but the little loft that he was working for. So I don't know. I just be liking for continuity of content, and they don't be giving me that. All right, so Savior snickered and hopped in Messiah's passenger side. The 5-minute drive to Blue's house filled Messiah with tension. He was anxious to see her. Besides Morgan, Blue had been the only other woman Messiah had ever loved, but their bond was different. Mo drove him mad. His emotions for her were so intense that he had a hard time staying sane when in her presence. He lived in a heightened reality with Morgan. Their love made him feel so raw that he hated it at the same time. The vulnerability. With Blue, he was different. Blue kept him sane, balanced. She grounded him, and he couldn't wait to see her. If anyone could help piece together fragments of his old life, she could. He pulled in front of the White House, and his gut tightened. The last time he had been there had been catastrophic. He could almost see the scene playing back in his mind. He and Mo on the front lawn screaming at each other. He had hurt her that day. Everyone saw it. He saw it, hanging off her shoulders, leaking from her eyes, vibrating in her voice. So Blue is the second person to know he's alive. Yeah, well, her son is the first. She didn't know, though, that he was alive. He's about to find out. Only her pain was acknowledged that day, but his hurt had been present too. His had been overwhelming because it was the day he learned that her love for him had no limits. She had been willing to forgive the unforgivable, and it had angered him, enraged him that she would be so selfless for him, that she would be so loyal to him, that she could love him so, that love didn't flee when in the face of adversity because everyone before her abandoned him, not Morgan. Not even ethic. The disappointment he had seen in their eyes that fated day could only be offspring of one emotion, of love, and it angered him. He hated them that day because although no one else knew, he knew that he couldn't stay because his fate was already decided. He had been sick and he was dying and they didn't know. They had no idea the resentments they caused in Messiah because before Morgan, he had been okay with dying. He had been cool with having his life snatched from him. Before her, he was getting money, fucking bitches, living fast and taking risks, going hard to make sure his name lived after he was gone. But after her, after drowning in her depths, after exploring her soul, after hearing his name on her lips and standing on the pedestal she placed him on, Messiah had wanted to live. He thought for sure she would leave like everyone else when she found out he was Mizon's brother, but he had witnessed her love double after finding out. She had run to him, and he had turned her away because he was pissed that he was dying and he could never, would never let her watch him fade to black. He exited the car and placed a hand on top of Savior's head as he guided him to the front door. He heard Blue's voice through the open screen door before he even knocked. "What do you mean he didn't get on the bus? Where the hell is my son?" she shouted. I'm right here, Ma, Savior said. Blue turned, and when she saw Messiah, the phone slipped from her grasp, hitting the floor. Uncle Messiah picked me up, Savior said. What up, Shorty Doo-Wah? Messiah greeted with a mischievous grin. Blue's lip trembled and her eyes misted. She choked a bit on her own damn breath as she reached for the kitchen counter to steady herself because her legs had gone weak. A ghost had snatched the strength right out of her. Messiah? Blue rushed him. I don't even know how you're in front of me right now. I wasn't so happy to see you. I would kill you. Oh, she said, if I wasn't so happy to see you, I would kill you, she cried, her tears falling with ease as her heartbeat threatened to tear through her chest. So tell him about the damn baby then, bitch. He squeezed her tight, strong arms, trapping her. He kissed the side of her head, getting emotional himself, but fighting the burning of his eyes by closing them. This woman was his best damn friend. He owed her everything. She had let him use her in ways that he knew had stained her soul. She had stuck by him, giving him everything, setting no limits in ways that would have eased his transition. She had loved him, and in return, he would always love her. He would never love her the most, but on a list where only one other had ever gotten to his heart, Blue had been added. Their friendship was potent, and he could never give her back all that she had given him. I missed your shit-talking, B, he said, chuckling before letting her go. Blue pulled back to look at him and couldn't help but to throw her arms around him again. She placed both hands on his shoulders and looked at him in disbelief. She touched him, moving her hands to his face. She couldn't believe he was in front of her, alive, breathing. She struggled to control her emotions as her face twitched, lip quivering, eyes prickling with tears. She shook her head. We got a lot to talk about. You have some explaining to do, boy. Have a seat. I'm almost done with dinner. You're staying. Amon's in Cali, so it's just me and Savior. We just got you back. No way is this going to be a quick visit, so I hope you didn't make plans. No plans. Just you, he replied. I hope you making Flint tacos. I need about 5 of those ASAP. Taco Tuesday ain't changed, boy. You already know, she replied, laughing through tears. Now, start at the beginning and leave nothing out. It's been 2 years, Messiah. Where the hell have you been? After 4 hours, 12 tacos, and a game of Monopoly with Savior, Blue and Messiah sat at her kitchen table. She was crying and holding his hand so tightly that her knuckles lightened. Why would you let everyone think you were dead, Messiah? I would have been there for you. You went through chemo and surgeries and rehab alone, Blue cried. She was distraught. I thought I was dead, B. They gave a nigga a 5% chance of surviving. The shit was everywhere. Cancer was everywhere. They cut me into so many pieces just to try to get it all out. I never thought I would live through that. I still question how I did. The pain, B. Messiah shook his head and lowered it, clearing his throat. It was worse than death. It was like the devil had me and I was in hell. I was just waiting to die. No need for everybody to go through that. A nigga know how to die. I didn't require company for that. I called the hospital. I came to the hospital. They told me your file had been archived, that it was with the patients that had been terminated. I threw a fit at that hospital when they refused to show me a body. They just kept saying I wasn't family, so they wouldn't divulge any information. And this whole time you're alive. What about Morgan, Messiah? What about her? I tried to call her after I found out. Even went to her place, but she was gone. She moved to London. I heard she has kids now. Shorty doo-wop got shorties, Messiah snickered. He already knew, but hearing it again was mind-numbing. There was no masking his somberness. He tried to be lighthearted about it, but he was heartbroken. He had imagined her with babies before, but they had been his babies, children they would share, ones that looked like him and loved like her. It injured him something serious to know she had received that gift from another man. Shit's wild. Messiah, Blue whispered. He never was good at concealing his emotions from her. She did what she was supposed to do, B. She moved on. She lived. But I gotta see her. I gotta put eyes on her because that's my baby. That's my baby girl. She said my name first, Blue, and she said it like nobody had ever said it before, like she loved saying it, like she loved me. And I just got to see her. I gotta see her so I can ask her to let me come home, B. Shorty gotta let me come home, and I know she changed the locks and all that, but it's still my house. I built it. She's still mine, he ranted, moving his hands in front of him like he was trying to grasp the notion of someone else taking his spot. What am I do about Mo? How a nigga supposed to appreciate this new air without her? I know I should stay away. I should just watch Shorty from across the street and let her grow and be beautiful, but a nigga like to pick his flowers and put them in my pocket. I gotta have her with me. I just got to. I can't fucking breathe when she's not around. For 2 years, doctor's been saving me, but living without her has been killing me. Well, that's what your funky ass get, nigga. Ethic told you to stay away. If you want Morgan, you'll have to get past him first, and I'm not talking about the way you're used to handling things. He isn't an enemy. He's your family. He's like her father, so getting rid of him hurts her. The only way to her is through love. You have to tap into the love she has for you and get his forgiveness before you can even get to her. A lot of people never get a second chance. This is yours. You handled her entire family wrong the first time. This is your chance to fix it. Ain't no talking to Ethic after what I did. He see my face, he bussin' first, Messiah said. Won't be no questions asked. Blue shrugged. You better make him listen, Messiah, or watch Morgan love someone else from afar. I'm pissed. That's the end of that chapter. I'm pissed that she still ain't told this nigga that she got a baby by him. Did she get a baby up for adoption or not? Like, what's the deal? Because she fucking playing around. And this is insane in the membrane here. Like, she did. Mm-mm. Okay. Let me get the next time stamp, child, because listen. Like, gotta let me wet my whistle a little bit. She is not his girl, Marva. It was too many M's. You know what? I'm so fucking mad. No, God. No. Blue's son was, You mean Savior, right? Was the first to know that whatchacallit was alive. You got me up here stuttering and shit like I'm having a goddamn seizure, Marvel. I'm so fucking mad at, I'm so mad at Messiah, the audacity to bring his bald-headed ass back into town like he ain't never left. Nigga, bye. No. I need her to fucking tell him the truth about his own baby so he'll go the fuck home and be with her ass and move around. Because this is some bullshit. This is fucking bullshit. All right, here we go. Listen, Linda, I'm annoyed. Chapter 20. Morgan sat at the dining room table. 12 seats in formal place settings separated her from Chris. The 6,000 square foot home was a mile from Michigan State and was the residence the Fredericks family owned in Michigan. I'm glad you decided to stay here, Morgan. Clear your head a bit and focus on what's important, Chris said. You don't have time to waste. I didn't say I was staying, Chris. I'm going to my place, Morgan said, as she picked at the plate of food before her. Kale salad, balsamic vinaigrette. What is this? This isn't what I ordered from the chef. Mo's face turned in irritation as she lifted eyes to Vash's mom. Pre-wedding food. We've got to get that waistline down if Vera Wang is going to work with you, Chris said. Morgan set her fork down, and it took everything in her to trap her thoughts inside her head. Her phone buzzed against the table. Not during meal service, Morgan, Chris said. Morgan's fingertips were on the edge of her phone. Her heart fluttered because the notification let her know it was Meek. It had been 4 days since she'd landed in Michigan. He had FaceTimed, not called, because they needed the eye-to-eye contact, but Morgan hadn't answered. I think she meant one call for each day that had passed. Mo hadn't answered once. Morgan didn't even know what to say or how to feel. It all felt like it was happening so fast and her heart was so exposed that she was afraid. She didn't want to talk on the phone. She needed FaceTime. She needed to see his deep-set eyes and dark skin. She needed to rest her head on his chest to hear the way his heart beat because when it beat too slow, it meant he was trying to maintain his composure. It meant he was lying. Whenever he was calm around her, it meant he was fighting his emotions, trying not to love her. It was when his pulse raced that he was telling the truth. Morgan knew that a phone call or text wouldn't suffice, but Chris had her under lock and key, escorted everywhere, days planned out like she were the Queen of England. wedding planners, preschool appointments for the twins, even though they were only 2 years old, looking at venues and homes for after the wedding because Bash would be buying her one as a gift. Not even a piece of time over the past 4 days had been left unaccounted for. Morgan had been put on a schedule so that she couldn't make any more decisions that would tarnish the formal announcement of their engagement. "Where are the twins?" she asked. "They're out back with Bash," Christiana answered. "They'll be spending the day with him while we try on dresses." "Who decided that?" Morgan asked. "I'd prefer if they were with me. Why are we trying on dresses already? How do you know I don't have plans today, Chris?" "Whatever's planned can wait. I have someone from the Detroit Free Press coming to cover you for the Society and Style section of their website," Chris said. "What?" Morgan called out. "Relax, Morgan. Your dress will be custom. Off-rack is mostly size 2s and 4s. We both know you aren't either of those. I'll just let people know that a new Fredericks woman is on the horizon. It's good for you. Your brand as a woman emerging on London's elite, Michigan's elite, a young medical student marrying into our family. If we make the right moves and establish a strong social circle, when you finally finish medical school, your practice will flourish. The money is in private practice. Chris, I haven't even told my family yet." "And why not?" Chris's tone was intolerant, like she couldn't fathom why Morgan wouldn't have bragged about the news. "Morgan, the ways you have benefited with this family holds value. The same way I pull strings for you at Cambridge, I can tie them back. I can knot them. One likes knots, dear. It's best for you to stay on board." "That sounds like a threat," Morgan said. "Come on, dear. You can't think you've gotten this far at Cambridge on your own merit. Every class, every grade, every milestone was paid for, Morgan. How devastating would a public scandal be if that news came out? You would be back at square one. Your career would be over before it even began," Chris said. "Now, eat the kale and like it." "What? Girl. You mean to tell me she did all that fucking studying for nothing and this old raggedy, lonely, bored bitch looking for somebody else to control has already been maneuvering and pulling strangalangs and shit and doing way the fuck too much? She could have not been studying then. What the fuck was the point? That's what I need to know. What was the point? Child, she better get the fuck out of there. I got a feeling these people will try to fucking kidnap her or some shit. This is sounding real fucking weird. This nigga's a creep stain. He's a whole fucking creep stain, and I don't like it. Morgan stood in front of the mirror. Here she was, not even 21 years old, and she was about to get married. She had promised herself to a man for forever, and she was sick to her stomach. This felt like a trap, like she was a butterfly trapped in a jar, and no matter how hard she flapped her wings, the glass she was encompassed in stopped her from freedom. The white wedding gown was beautiful. She felt just like the princesses in the stories she'd read coming up, like the one stuck in the tower. The bitch with the long hair that let people pull on it hurt her just to climb to the top. Yup, Morgan felt just like that. Morgan pressed flat hands to the bodice of the ball gown and sighed. "Can we get a smile, Morgan?" Chris said. Morgan looked at her reflection and then at her future mother-in-law, who sat behind her, legs crossed at the ankles and wearing vintage Chanel. She gave up a tight-lipped smile, a disingenuous leer, and the cameras flashed. This wasn't what this moment was supposed to feel like. She was almost sure of it. Her eyes watered. "The bride is crying," the journalist cooed. "Aw, this will be amazing for the viewers. Morgan?" Aria's voice was so soft that it almost got lost in the excitement of the others in the room. Morgan's eyes met Aria's in the reflection of the mirror. "Uh-uh, she needs a minute," Aria said, standing. "Well, unfortunately, she doesn't have a minute. The Free Press opened up their entire schedule to be here," Chris stated, as she sipped champagne from the crystal flute. "It's cute that you think I was asking," Aria stated. She stood. "Everybody get the fuck out. Out, out," Aria said. "How about we just take a beat?" the photographer suggested. The staff from the newspapers exited the room, heading back to the main floor as Chris stayed seated. The dead stare Aria placed on Bash's mom was enough to make her rise from her seat. "I suppose I should go smooth things over with them," Chris said. "Mm-hmm," Aria said. When they were alone, Morgan caved. "I need him," Morgan cried. "Okay, Mo, I'll call Ethic," Aria whispered. "I don't even know why you're here trying on dresses. You haven't even told your fine-ass daddy. Ooh, Aria, Morgan protested. I'm just saying, Aria snickered. If you're afraid to tell him, it isn't right. I'm not talking about ethic, Morgan whispered. Who are you? A meek, Morgan whispered. I need a meek. Aria's eyes widened. Please call him, Morgan whispered. Morgan, Aria exclaimed. What is happening between you and a meek? He hit that one time. You think he's going to come running up in here after one time? What you sitting on, girl? Is your whole damn vagina dipped in gold? It's dipped in meek, bitch. Get him here now, Morgan answered. Ooh, 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 ooh. I hope he come. I'm literally rocking in my chair. A knock at the door interrupted them. We really need to continue, Chris said, peeking in. Aria looked at Morgan. I will chase these motherfuckers out of here right now, Aria said. Just say the word, sis, and I'm stepping. I'm locked in this goddamn castle, Morgan whispered. Just take my phone and drop my location. He'll come. Nigga, open your mouth, Issa said as he gripped the collar of the man on the floor before him. No, please, man, the man sniveled. Now you begging, nigga? Now you showing respect, Issa asked. He bit into his bottom lip as his fist crashed into the man's face. Me, man, please. The call was desperate, like he needed someone to intervene. Amik stood behind Issa, one leg propped against the wall as he held his cell phone in one hand. He held out his other hand. The word Flint was spelled out in ink on his fingers. He balled his fist, flexing it casually, calmly, without looking in the man's direction. He said, nigga, you know the rules. They're clear. We putting whole loaves of bread on your table and you thieving, nigga? You still running around the kitchen, scrounging for more, stealing crumbs, like a fucking rat, just getting what the fuck you can, Meek stated. Beg God, nigga. Don't beg me. I don't save lives. I end them, homie. Issa stuffed a handful of Xannies in the man's mouth. Swallow that shit, nigga, before I blow your head off, Issa stated. The next step should have been death. They were an unforgiving crew, but when Morgan's name appeared on Meek's phone screen and he viewed the pin she had sent, revealing her location, Meek's plans changed instantly. He could get to her, or he could finish his business. Cleaning up a body would take all day. He only had a small window of opportunity to see Mo, and his gut told him that she couldn't wait. His intuition urged him to drop everything. There had been no message behind the location, no words, just coordinates. Yo, Issa, we out. Let the nigga breathe, Meek stated. Looks like your prayers were answered, G. Tighten up. Issa asked no questions. He pushed the man to the ground, and they stepped over him as they walked out of the warehouse. Since when you giving niggas second chances? Issa asked. I got other business, Meek answered. I'm gonna get with you. He climbed onto his bike, wishing he had time to stop and switch to his car. If Morgan wanted to leave with him, he preferred the safety of four wheels. Walking light and such meant that he had to think of all possibility of danger. Caring for someone like Morgan meant taking no risks with her at all, but it was no time. He hit the highway as his mind did circles, thinking of the reasons why she had ignored all his efforts to reach out since Vegas. He had called and sent texts only one a day because anything more would give her proof that he was pressed. It would show her that he hadn't slept, that she lived in the back of his mind, and that he had replayed the vision of her sitting on his tongue in his mind on repeat. He had turned down women for 3 days just because they weren't her. He had it fucking bad for her, and it bothered him because the fact that she could go 3 days without calling him meant she had the power. All the cards were in her pretty little hands. When he pulled up to the address on his screen, he frowned. The wedding dress boutique threw him for a loop. He parked his motorcycle directly in front and removed his helmet before climbing down. When he entered, he spotted her instantly. White dress, veil hanging from the crown of her head, standing on her tiptoes. Hi, can I help you? A woman asked as she eyed him curiously. Nah, baby, you can't. She can help me. Only her, he answered, voice a ghost of his normal baritone as he stood there, enchanted by the fucking blessing that was Morgan in a white dress. His heart ached. He took steps in her direction until her eyes lifted in the mirror, discovering his presence. The only thing missing from her face was happiness. She had the dress and the tiara and all the makings of a bride, but that smile was missing. As soon as she saw him, it appeared. Morgan startled him as she came down off the pedestal she was standing on. She ran barefoot across the store and into his arms. Get me out of here, she whispered. Morgan, Chris called after her. Aria stepped in her path, blocking her as Morgan ran out of the door in the white wedding dress. Morgan lifted the dress, balling the mountains of fabric around her waist as she hopped onto the back of his bike. He placed the helmet on her head. Morgan, Christiana shouted as she emerged from the shop. Go, go, Morgan urged. Amit kicked off the stand and rotated his throttle before taking off. Morgan laughed in his ear as she held on to him. I can't believe I just did that, she shouted. Meek chuckled as he carried her all the way to Detroit to his loft, the one she wanted to redecorate and make her own. Morgan climbed down and Meek reached for the tips of her fingers, catching his pinky to hers and then pulling her into him. Morgan beamed as one hand caught her chin and he tipped her neck back, forcing her eyes to meet his. He held her prisoner there for a beat before kissing her. Are the twins with him? He asked. Not anymore. Aria sent a text to Alani and Ethic to pick them up from him. When she texted you, she texted them too, Morgan answered. He nodded. Come on, he said, leading her into the building. They stood on separate sides of the elevator, him basking in all his cool and her letting her nerves eat her alive. She was questioning everything in this moment. If she left Bash, her life would be ruined. Everything she had worked hard for would be gone in the blink of an eye, but she would have a Meek. Would she? Would he stick around, or was this just something fun for him to do in the moment? Morgan was unsure of so many things, and her bond with Amik was too new to question his intent. She didn't want to scare him away. You're beautiful, Mo, he complimented. Like, for real, I don't know bad bitch shit. I don't know face full of makeup shit. Just fucking stunning, yo. I lose time looking at you, love. You just take niggas' hearts and eat them for breakfast, Morgan Atkins. Fucking playing games with me, yo. He scoffed and shook his head like he was her latest victim. Like, he didn't even know how he had let it happen. Morgan's entire body warmed. It was statements like that. The way he looked at her, the way he spoke to her, any thought she had about making a mistake with him was erased. How long do I have you? He asked. She shrugged. How long do you want me? She counted. He finessed his beard and crossed the elevator. You don't want me to answer that, love, he whispered. I answer that and you're never going back. He placed his hands on the wall behind her and leaned into her. Morgan didn't even wait for him to ask this time. She gave up her lips without protest. No permission needed. They were his, so why ask? Who asked to ride their own bike anyway? The elevator opened to Amik's penthouse and Morgan stepped out first. To her surprise, the wallpaper in the foyer was gone and replaced with gray paint and white trim. She looked at him in shock, but he pushed forward into the loft like it was no big deal. The frill of the huge gown was cumbersome as she followed behind him. I think I just stole a $10,000 gown, she laughed. Call the boutique and put it on my card, Amik said. He reached into his back pocket and removed his wallet, removing his credit card. He held it out for her. Just like that, huh? She asked. Just like that, he answered. Aria has my phone, she said. He tossed her his without a second thought. Code's the same. 11:28, he said, just in case she'd forgotten. Morgan didn't even feel the need to snoop as she unlocked his phone. He gave up pertinent information without falter. It made her not want to look. She placed the call, paid the boutique, and then tossed his phone back to him. He spent the 10 bands like it was $10 without a second thought. Now, can you help me out of this? She turned her back to him and moved her hair out of the way. Amik rose from the couch and placed hands on her hips before placing lips to the back of her neck. Nah, keep it on for a little bit, he said. Amik pulled out his phone and he pressed play. The sound of guitar strings played throughout the loft. She turned to him and he stood in front of her, towering over her, taking her fingertips and lacing them with one hand. The slightest touch from him made Morgan quiver. Never thought that we would ever be more than friends. Now I'm all confused, because for you, I have deeper feelings. Half crazy. Musique was singing her emotions, except she was more like full crazy. She was too invested in Amik, all in, so involved. Because my mind's gone half crazy, because I can't leave you alone. They didn't even dance. They just stood there, his hand on her face, her eyes locked on his as the words to the song did all the work. She could see the confusion in his eyes, the turmoil. I missed you, she whispered. That's what your mouth says, Morgan Atkins, but you ain't hit a nigga line, he said. I couldn't, but I thought about you. God, I thought about you every second. I'm here now. Can we just be here right now in the present? Just me and you? Their kiss lasted forever. The song played 5 times and they never tired. It was like she had him back in middle school where somehow kisses were enough. Can I see your phone? She asked out of the blue. He frowned but handed it over. No checking it first, no clearing things she couldn't see from it. Just transparency. She typed for a few seconds and the song changed. I see your face when I close my eyes. She tossed the phone to the table and lifted mischievous eyes to him. Ro James, Amig said. She nodded. You want to dance to Ro James? He assumed. Morgan shook her head. I want to fuck to Ro James, she whispered. Pretty ass mouth, dirty ass lips, Amig whispered. Gotta shake shit up sometimes, give people what they don't expect, she smiled. She turned her back to him and held up her hair. All day I dream about sexing you. Get this off me. This time he complied. He kissed her neck and then slid the zipper down south, his lips following, kissing every inch of her back that was revealed on the way down. By the time the dress fell to the floor, Amik was on his knees, hands steepled because he wasn't a liar. He prayed before he ate. He followed Morgan as she swayed her hips from side to side, riding that beat like only she could. She felt the sting of his hand, a smack. He couldn't help it. She had so much to appreciate. He placed a hand on the small of her back and then pressed down, bending her over. Morgan placed her knees on the couch and Amik devoured her from behind. You're gonna spoil me, Amik, she groaned. Every fucking time I see you. He had to mumble the words because he had a mouthful. The delicacy between her thighs marinated on his tongue. She was like wine. You had to let it sit for a few seconds. Let it breathe on your taste buds. Taste the notes behind the initial flavor before you swallowed. Morgan reached for him. She had indulged in him twice, and neither time had she tasted him. That couldn't happen a third time. She turned and sat on the couch, destroying his cushions with her wet, staining them. But neither cared as she reached for his jeans. When he was in her hands, she couldn't help but lick there. Morgan didn't repel at the taste of him. The anticipation of her had him coated in need. A little pre-cum on the tip of him that Morgan took her time cleaning up. Oh, shit. Amik wrapped four fingers around her neck. He lifted one leg onto the couch and tensed into her. He was a head connoisseur, but he didn't know if he had ever had better. Sight alone, his strength between her pouted lips, that tongue going to work, her face tensing as she tried her hardest to slay Goliath, gagging on that thing, spitting on it, as those pretty fucking short French manicured teeth on his strength. She was the fucking best. The fact that she was never supposed to be on her knees for any man, but was here before him, submitting to him, made Amik's prowess heightened. So good, boy, Morgan moaned. She moaned like she was receiving instead of giving, and it made him want to give, made him want to be benevolent. Lie down, love, he whispered, as he moved her hair out of her face. Morgan had a mouthful, and she didn't stop. Morgan. She looked up. Her name on his tongue barely even existed. It was always love. Sometimes Miss Atkins. Sometimes first, then last, but never just Morgan. It caught her attention, and he stared at her for a beat before lowering to his knees. She sat on the couch, and he pulled her to the edge before one thumb exposed the source of her pleasure. Tell me what you want, Mo. Eat my fucking pussy, boy, and stop playing, she cried. He snickered and lowered his head. Morgan saw God. He pushed her legs to her ears, exposing everything, folding her thick ass up in a pretzel as he mopped her up, tongue everywhere. He plugged her leak, eating her with a hunger she didn't even realize he had for her. Damn, love. Amik groaned. Morgan loved how vocal he was. If he liked it, he said it. If he couldn't stand it much longer, he announced that shit like he was a captain flying high, that he was wanting his passions about turbulence. Morgan felt his tongue in places where tongues didn't belong, and her eyes closed. This nasty-ass fucking shit, she thought. Then she felt her body stretch because no way was she built to take a dick so long and wide. He dug fingers into the cushion of her ass and pulled her cheeks apart, went deep, then pushed them together, smothering his dick as he pulled out. It seemed like he was withdrawing forever, all the way to the head, fucking inch after inch. Then, ah, Morgan screamed as he pulled her hair with one hand and gripped one hip. Bracing for impact, Morgan tensed. She felt her apprehension, and he pulled out. His lips touched her back, then her ass. Relax, love. It'll never hurt with me, he whispered. Morgan exhaled her tension, and then he kissed her clit. One time, a quick peck like he was coming back to it again soon. Then he split her pink again. Morgan's sex pushed out air, farting, because he was so big he had left her vacant. Now he was moving in. Now he was knocking down walls, and Morgan shouted as she reached for her clit. She could press, or he could press the accelerator, and she would steer. Morgan's fingers were soaked as she rubbed and he stroked. Her brow crashed, her mouth fell open, and she reached behind her body, grabbing his neck as she trembled. Let that shit go, he whispered. Her sex throbbed around and massaging it. Damn, baby. Throw that shit at a nigga, he moaned. Morgan's body was making all types of noise. Pussy farting, ass clapping, throat tapping, grunts of pleasure, and then whines of delirium sneaking out. He pulled her up onto his lap, and Morgan reached both hands behind her body, pulling his head to her ear. Talk to me, Amik, she whispered. Want me to talk to you, love? He whispered. He reached around her body and found her clit. Yes, she shouted. I found true love in you. Ooh, ooh, come for me. Be a good girl and wet that shit, love, he whispered. Lips pressed to the back of her neck. Morgan was in heat, bouncing on him, matching his stroke. This is your dick, love. Shit ain't for nobody else, just you, he groaned. God damn, just you, Mo. Promise me, Amik, she whimpered. Promise me it's mine. Property of Queen Atkins, love, he whispered in her ear. Wet ass. Ain't nobody wetting dick like you, love. Shit is yours, Mo. Take it with you when you leave, baby. Ah, she screamed. Meek. He licked the nape of her neck and Morgan exploded. He bent her over, then grabbed one of her feet as he increased the intensity of his stroke. Hard, fast. Meek, Meek. She felt him pulsing, and a part of her wanted to get pregnant. Sex this good could only result in a baby. Fuck it. She'd be his baby mama. She'd wear that badge with fucking honor. But he pulled out, using better judgment than what Morgan possessed currently. Shit, he groaned. He stood and pulled her hand, forcing her to rise with him. She followed him to the bathroom, a shower, a quick round two, because Morgan couldn't endure anything else. He had her coming from touch alone, so she wasn't worth much more than a quick one. When they climbed out, Morgan was all smiles. So, skating, he said, as he dried her hair with the plush white towel in his hands. You want to go skating? I need you available tomorrow. Okay, she said. Just tell me when to be ready. I'll pick you up at 3. That sound good, he asked. She nodded as he kissed the tip of her nose. Don't be late. A nigga gonna always pull up right on time. Never late. I ain't missing no shots with you, love. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, this is the last chapter. How is all this going to come together in 8 minutes? It's only 8 minutes left in the book. No, 6 minutes. You dig? Six. I'm annoyed. Sinead said, Ari is my best friend. She a rider. Absolutely. Kim at work. Girl, don't you get yourself in trouble in there talking about, ooh, yes. And they knock on your door talking about, you all right in there? Lord, have mercy. All right, let me get this time stamp, child. Listen, no lie. Mm-mm. All right, y'all gotta hold on and let me wet my whistle right quick. Okay, sorry, y'all. All right, here we go. This is insane. Chapter 21. Messiah stood off in the distance watching Ethic. He had been there for hours witnessing the remnants of love as Ethic sat on the grass, his head leaned back on the headstone of Raven Atkins. He could see Ethic interacting, talking and laughing as if Raven was speaking back to him. Messiah wondered if Mo had ever done the same for him. Had she visited his grave just to get a little piece of him? Had they had conversations that transcended life and death? He hoped so. He prayed she had at least thought of him from time to time, because he had thought of her every single day. Are you going to say something? We've been sitting here for hours, Blue said. Go talk to him, Messiah. The nigger might fucking shoot me, Messiah scoffed. He really might, and I deserve it. This is crazy, Messiah. The man is sitting at his dead love's grave. He's not carrying a gun, Blue reasoned. Ethic is always carrying, Messiah shot back. He walked over to Ethic, and when he was within voice's reach, he said, OG. Ethic lifted his head, and shock wore away like a flash of lightning as confusion, then rage took over. Ethic stood, hand dipped to his waist from instinct alone, adding the mistrust that existed between them, and Messiah couldn't guarantee he would walk out the cemetery alive. I'm not on no bullshit, Messiah said, lifting his shirt and turning around to show he wasn't strapped. Niggas like you are always on bullshit, Messiah, Ethic stated, voice deep and unforgiving. I thought you were dead. I was close to it, Messiah revealed. You left my fucking... Ethic stopped himself and cleared his throat. I picked up a lot of broken pieces after you disappeared, Messiah. You broke Mo down even before she thought you died. And now you come back like it's nothing, like the shit you do don't affect her. The longer he spoke, the louder he got. Anger spilled from him. It poured out of him. Shorty said I could come home, Messiah whispered. She said she'd always be home. His face contorted. I ain't never had nobody, man, until her. Then you should have taken better care of her. I told you not to fuck with her, and you did it anyway, knowing you would hurt her. I told you no, little nigga. I know. I want to say I'd do it different if I could go back, but I wouldn't, OG. I love her, Messiah said. I'd risk it all every time just to feel that with her. Where the fuck you been, Messiah? You don't leave somebody you love for 2 years. I'm trying real hard to control myself. You have no idea what you left behind. I have cancer, big homie. I didn't come back because I couldn't, and I left because I didn't want her to see me die. I sent her every dime I ever saved in the game, $1 million check, sold my businesses, my houses, all the cars, and cleared the safe so I could leave her with something. I thought I was dead. God had other plans, Messiah said. Cancer. Ethic said the word like he was pondering it. What stage? 4, Messiah revealed. Ethic closed his eyes and rubbed a hand over his head. Messiah had stressed him many times over the years, but this time had to be the most weighted. It was everywhere, man. Probably still is, but the doctors say it's chilling for now. Remission. I got a little time. Whatever time I got, I want to spend it with her. I want to see her face, man, because some days that face was the only thing that got me through. I've had a hard time, man. His voice cracked and his lip trembled. Ethic's defenses lowered. And you went through it by yourself? Chemo? Radiation? Ethic asked. I ain't got nobody, man, Messiah said. He was broken as he dropped his head and tears fell from his eyes. He sniffed loudly, pinching the bridge of his nose. Ethic advanced on him, giving him a strong pat on the back, followed by a strong embrace. Pick your head up, boy, Ethic said, clenching his jaw because he was fighting through rage to feel empathy for someone he had looked at as a brother. At times, he had thought of him as a son. I need her, man. I went through all that, so much pain, just to get back to her. I can't not have her. I need her back. Messiah broke down. He sniffed away his emotion, only for it to flood him again. It took him a minute to gain his composure. Morgan is delicate, Messiah. This isn't something you can just drop on her. She's been through a lot. The timing has to be right. Ethic thought about the suicide attempt and the birthing of twins that Messiah didn't even know belonged to him. He wanted to tell him, but neither secret was his to share. Morgan had to reveal those things, and he feared that Messiah's sudden return may be detrimental to Morgan's health. I'll do whatever it takes, whatever you say. I need you to help me, OG. I need you to help me come home to her. Help me, man. Nobody ever helped me. I was little as fuck, man. Nobody did shit, Messiah cried. Don't leave me stuck, man. Just help me get her back. She the only one that ever loved me, man. I gotta get her back. Messiah's head landed in the center of Ethic's chest as he sobbed, and Ethic tightened his face as he placed his hands on Messiah's head. He knew Messiah wasn't talking about Morgan anymore. He was talking about his childhood, about surviving molestation, about abuse confusing him, making him angry. He was talking about every single adult in his life that was supposed to protect him, inflicting harm or disregard. Ethic couldn't be another. Somebody had to step up. I got you, Ethic said. I got you. Now, pause. Fuck all that bullshit. He should have said, my friend Blue was with me for a little bit. But then I even ran away from her. Okay? Because what he needs to understand is he got a baby with Blue, and I don't know why the fuck she ain't told him that. I'm confused as to why that hasn't been revealed yet. Did she give the fucking baby away to somebody? That's what I need to know. Relief flooded Messiah as Epic held him. Another man had never touched him without inflicting harm. Another man had never fathered him. And the void Epic was feeling in this moment was healing. Messiah was in desperate need of forgiveness, and Epic was willing to offer absolution. Messiah was back in the city, but he wasn't home. Home was with Morgan Atkins, and he was determined to earn her back. What he didn't know was that he was starting late in the race for her heart. There were two other contenders, and Messiah was already losing. Winning her wouldn't be easy, because now that she had been loved correctly, he wouldn't be able to come to her with anything less than his best. And we don't even want it. Get the fuck out of here, nigga. That's the end of the book. This nigga's trash. Boo-boo. Dookie. We don't want your ass back. Go on somewhere, cancer boy. Shit. Coming back in here with this bullshit. Go the fuck away. I done called this nigga cancer boy. I'm so motherfucking disrespectful because I'm mad. I'm annoyed. I just feel like this is I don't know what the fuck. Let me see, y'all. I'm trying to figure out how I want to do this. All right. Okay, so we just read Butterfly 1. Okay, back. All right. Wait. There you go. Okay, so next on this is a pretty short little, oh shit, it's got 14 chapters, child. I know you lying. It's The Invitation. So this book is before the other one. All right, so y'all know how I do it. All right, where am I going? Okay, Shanae said, and he should have said, remember you told me to get lost or you was going to kill me. Yeah, I get that. He should have said that, but fuck him. I want him out of here. I want him to go on. Not you had to dip out and leave. Yes, that chapter was all the things, but it still wasn't better than the Raphael experience. Listen. Baby. I don't even know what to say about that. Y'all, I had to fucking put the timestamp for that shit on there so y'all can get right to it. And I don't even remember what fucking book it was in. But whatever, if you go to the timestamps on all of them books, child, you'll see it where it says the Raphael Oh, child, somebody who shall remain nameless hit me up in the DMs and said, thank you. said, I only hit one time stamp. Thank you. Oh, Lord have mercy. They listened to that first and then went back and listened to the whole book. I'm like, you know what? My sippers and speakers are slow boppers for Christ. Y'all some freaks. That's what y'all are. Oh, Lord. But I don't know who we like better. Or I should say who y'all like better. I know who I like. But I don't know if y'all like Anias Duke, his fat ass brother, or if y'all like Hunter Valentine. Child, listen. I don't know. No, y'all better figure that shit out. All right, anyway, you ain't got to choose, child. Just be a hoe and be like, your turn, your turn, your turn, your turn, your turn. Because listen, ain't nothing wrong with that either, you hear me? All right, so the next book is The Invitation, an Ethic Holiday Edition. So let me read y'all the synopsis, because y'all know how I do at the end of the book. I read y'all the synopsis of the next book. All right, it says a new baby is on the way for Ethic and Alani, but the stress of her high-risk pregnancy is weighing on the couple heavily. When the routine of their love changes, Alani's hormones send them on an emotional roller coaster filled with suspicion and miscommunication, with challenges from the children they have already on the horizon, and Ethic's involvement with Nair's city council run, things in the Okafor household are in disarray. Glimpse into the everyday life of Ashley Antoinette's favorite literary family while you wait on the highly anticipated sequel to her hit novel, Butterfly. All right. So they're inviting the Ash Army to their baby shower, but expect some bumps along the way. Mm-hmm. So that's what it is. Yes, slow bopper for Christ, Alani child, all over again. All right, so that's what's next, child. That's all I can tell y'all, you heard me? That's literally all I can tell y'all. So, yeah, we will we'll attack that in the next live stream, I'm guessing, at some point, child. Right now, I got to get off of here, honey, and handle up on a little business. All right? So, listen. I know y'all about to travel the highways and byways of the YouTube-verse, y'all. I saw a couple folks that, you know, everybody seems to like go live while I was live streaming. So I'm sure y'all can catch them at the end. Well, red ball it back, y'all, depending on how the people's behave. I don't know how these folks give it up around here. All right, so listen, y'all go forth and be great. Look both ways before you cross the streets, okay? Because I want y'all to come back to the speakeasy in one piece, all right? So thank you, Love Jones, moderator extraordinaire, for being such a wonderful moderator. I truly, truly appreciate you, okay? And listen, y'all, if you didn't already, like the video on your way out the door. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all.